Hello everyone, and welcome back to Digital Academy, the complete Python development tutorial for beginners. Welcome to Python A to Z, the complete Python development course for beginners. Within this entire course, you will go through step-by-step tutorials, covering your environment setup, the basic concepts and features of Python, but also some more complicated and advanced tasks to become a Python developer. You will discover and learn variables and data types, statements and conditions, loops, functions, lists and dictionaries, input and outputs, files, classes and objects, modules and packages, errors and exceptions handling, virtual environment, threading, databases, regular expressions, web applications and network, scientific data analysis, artificial intelligence and machine learning, but also graphical user interface apps, and so forth. Everything useful for someone who wants to learn to code in Python. Whether you are new to programming or an experienced developer who wants to learn a new language and enlarge his skills, it is easy to learn and use Python. Therefore, this course is for students, employees, and anyone who wants to start programming, or more likely wants to learn Python language, but with absolutely no prior programming knowledge required. At the end of this course, you might be able to automate some of your tasks in your everyday life, even the more difficult ones. From some very basic scripts, so you can have more free time for you and your family. Or watching a website for any changes. Organizing your movies. Even manage your personal finance. There is not limit besides your imagination. You would like to achieve this goal in no time? Keep in mind that you should above all learn at your own rhythm, with discipline and practice. Are you ready to learn Python? Let's get started. Enroll now and be part of this journey. Digital Academy, enroll now, learn free. Please subscribe. Hit the notification bell. Like, comment, and share. In this first video of a long series, you will discover what is Python and some of its features or benefits, but also why is it getting so popular, especially these last few years? What is Python used for? What are your career opportunities? Then, finally, what to learn and where to start? Do you want to find answers at some of these questions? Let's play this video and start with what is Python? Python is a general-purpose programming language, which is easy to learn and dynamically initialized. It has an easy and elegant syntax, with high-level and dynamic semantics, which makes it an ideal language for beginners, scripting, and rapid application development. Python was first released in 1991, and created by Guido van Rossum, a Dutch programmer, best known as the author of the Python programming language, who wanted to design a language, very simple to write, and easy to read. Thus, Python is much easier to learn than other programming languages, and helps you create beautiful applications, with less effort. But, you're wondering, what features and benefits does Python offer? There are many features provided, so are the benefits of learning Python, especially as your first language. Let's start with the benefits of learning Python. Easy. Python is the best languages to get started with, and the language preferred by beginners and pros alike. Its easy syntax and high-level features makes it one of the best languages for anybody who wants to start programming. Free. Python is an open-source language, which means that is it free for everyone to use. It can be freely modified and redistributed, for any purpose, commercial or not. Application. Python can be used to develop almost anything, desktop, mobile and web applications. Plus, it is very useful, in many areas. Data analysis, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and so forth. Library and support. Python has a massive support base, thanks to the fact that it is open source, and community developed. Millions of like-minded developers work with the language, on a daily basis. And they continue to improve core functionality, which makes Python even better, and more efficient. Thus, it is a great way to network with other developers, share, and develop your skills. You can now understand, why people in the world love Python so much. But, what are its features? Simplicity. Python is a language that is remarkably easy to learn, which means that it is much easier to get your programs up and running. Since it requires a simple, elegant and beginner-friendly syntax that focuses on readability, the programs you write are much easier to read, even if you are not a skilled programmer. This is mainly because it is closer to the human language, or how we write words, instead of a language that computers use to read. Developers can read and translate Python code much easier than other languages. In turn, this reduces the cost of program maintenance and development, because it allows teams to work collaboratively, and without significant language or experience barriers. Interpreted. Python supports multiple programming paradigms, including procedural, object-oriented, and functional programming. Most importantly, Python is an interpreted language, which means that the written code is actually not translated into a computer-readable format. Python codes are executed line by line, which makes debugging errors much easier and efficient. But this comes at a cost, as it is much slower than other compiled programming languages. Object orientation. Object-oriented programming is an approach used for modeling concrete and real-world entities into software objects, which have some data associated with them, and can perform certain functions. For instance, an object could represent a person with a name, an age, an address, etc. And with behaviors like walking, talking, or running. Its object-oriented approach aims to help programmers write clear and logical code for small and large-scale projects. Portability. There is no exclusivity, as Python and all the necessary tools are available on all major platforms. It is compatible with a long list of computers and operating systems, like Windows, Linux, macOS, and more. Furthermore, it uses a similar interface on each one of those platforms, which means you can jump between them easily, and if necessary. Embeddable and extensible. Python can be embedded into an application, which will provide a programmable interface for users of that app. This is a great feature, if you are putting together an app that will require working with Python, in a terminal. Additionally, Python supports the use of modules and packages, which means that programs can be designed in a modular style, and code can be reused across a variety of projects. Even better, it can be shared and scaled for use in other projects, once you have developed the module or package that you need. It is very easy to import or export. Libraries. Python comes with the standard Python library, offering integrated support for a variety of common programming tasks, like syncing with web servers, searching through text, and modifying files. For a majority of other languages, you have to create this content from scratch. Python also has an amazing community that has built a number of additional useful tools, and you could use them in your own programs. Need to work with PDF documents? There is a comprehensive tool for that. Want to collect data from web pages? No need to start from scratch. Python powers Django, a complete and open-source web application framework, which could be used to simplify and speed the development process. Open source. Python has a massive support base, thanks to the fact that it is open-source and community-developed. Millions of like-minded developers work with the language on a daily basis. And they continue to improve core functionality. The latest version of Python continues to receive enhancements and updates. Therefore, it is a great way to network with other developers, share, and develop your skills. One of the most promising benefits of Python is that the Python interpreter and the extensive standard library are freely available in both source and binary forms for all the major platforms. It can be downloaded from the Python website and may be freely modified and redistributed for any purpose, commercial or not. Since Python is available under an open source license, there are no licensing fees either, despite the fact that it is copyrighted. The same site also contains distributions of, and pointers to, many free third-party Python modules, as well as programs and tools, but also additional documentations, and so on. If this description of Python over your head, don't worry. You will understand it soon enough. What you really need to take away from these sections is that Python is a programming language used to develop softwares and web apps, including mobile. It is relatively easy to learn, since the necessary tools and documentations are available to all, and free of charge. That makes Python accessible to almost anyone. If you have the time to learn, you can create some amazing things. Therefore, it can be used as a stepping stone into other programming languages and frameworks. Anyone can begin working with the language, all it takes is a bit of patience and a lot of practice. If you are an absolute beginner, and this is your first time working with any type of coding language, Python is definitely something you want. But why is Python getting so popular? Because of all its features and benefits. You might have heard that Python is popular. On one hand, it may seem that it doesn't really matter how popular a language is, if you can build the app you want to build with it. But, for better or worse, in software's development, popularity is a strong indicator of the high quality of libraries you will have available, as well as the number of job openings. So, is Python actually that popular? Yes, and there are plenty of stats to back this one. Let's look at some analytics available and presented by stackoverflow.com. They run as it's called, Stack Overflow Trends. Here you can look at the trends for various technologies by tag. When we compare Python to the other likely candidates you could pick to learn programming, you will see one is unlike the others. Notice the incredible growth of Python, compared to the flatline or even downward trend of the other usual candidates. If you are betting your future on the success of a given technology, which one would you choose, from this list? You got it, Python has a lot to offer, and you will soon be able to write your own scripts. What is Python used for? Actually, pretty much anything you want. Most automation, data mining, and big data platforms rely on Python. Python can also be used to process text, display numbers or images, even solve scientific equations, and save data. In short, it is used behind the scenes to process a lot of elements you might need or encounter on your devices. This is because it is the ideal language to work with for general purpose tasks. For instance, it is used for GUI applications, games development, scraping data from websites, web and software development, system administration utilities, data analysis, machine learning, and many more. The Python programming language, also referred to as a scripting language, has considerably changed these last few years, because Python is now used to write large, commercial-style applications, instead of just banal ones. Thus, this reliance on Python has grown even more, so as the internet gained popularity. Not only is Python a friendly and fun language to learn, it also powers the technology behind multiple world-class companies. Actually, a large majority of web applications and platforms now rely on Python, including Google's search engine, YouTube platform, and the web-oriented transaction system of the New York Stock Exchange. You know that the language must be pretty serious when it comes to powering a stock exchange system. In fact, there are also many other big companies, among Pinterest, Instagram, Netflix, Spotify, Disney, Yahoo, Nokia, IBM, and many others, to name just a few. You are probably wondering why any of this matters? That's because, once you learn Python, you will never have a shortage of ways to utilize your skill. Not to mention, since a lot of big companies rely on the language, you can make good money as a Python developer. Career opportunities. In this dynamic world where everything changes at a rapid rate, the popularity of Python never seems to cease. Today, Python certification is one of the most sought-after skills in the entire programming domain. Have you ever wondered if it is really worth it? Python, as a programming language, is easy and simple to learn. Python cuts development time in half with its simple-to-read syntax and easy compilation feature. Also, it has plenty of libraries that support data analysis, manipulation, and visualization. Therefore, it has evolved as the most preferred language and considered to be the next big thing and a must for professionals. By the end of 2019, Python was delivering some impressive numbers. A recent Indeed.com inquiry also revealed at least 55,000 Python jobs in the United States, with exponential salary figures. You can find many job offers on the market. Most of the companies are seeking for the following profiles, which may require Python skills: software engineer, Python developer, research analyst, data scientist, software developer. Are you now ready to learn Python? But you don't know how to get started? Or even what to learn? Whether you are new to programming, or a professional software developer, looking to dive into a new language, this course will teach you all of the Python basics that you need to get started on your own projects, which are Python syntax, variables, data types, operators, conditions, methods and functions, file handling, OOP, and so many more. No matter what your ultimate goals may be, if you work with a computer at all, you will soon be finding endless ways to improve your life, by automating tasks, and solving problems, with Python programs that you will create. Let's practice. Now, let's dig in. Install Python on your PC, or Mac. Then set up your environment, so you can start learning, and, more importantly, practicing. Getting Python. Python is a free, open-source software that works on Windows, Linux, Mac, and various other platforms. Many operating systems, such as macOS and Linux, come with Python pre-installed. The version that comes with your operating system is almost always out of date, and may not even be a full Python installation. Therefore, it is essential that you have the most recent version of Python, so that you can follow along successfully, with the examples in this entire Python development course for beginners. But you are confused, since there are multiple versions of Python, and you do not even know which one to choose? Don't worry, this video will help you download and install Python, plus your new favorite editor. Choosing a Python version. There are two major versions of Python available, Python 2, also known as Legacy Python, and Python 3. It can be confusing for both new and seasoned programmers on deciding between Python 2 or 3. Fortunately, there are few syntactical differences between the two of them. And, you can run even both versions, on your computer. To check out whether Python is already installed on your machine, or your current version, open the terminal and run the following command. Python v. If you see a response from Python, some information will appear on the screen, including, the word Python, followed by the version number, and the build information. Python is already installed, but may need an update. Which version is right for you? Well, that's up to you. Honestly, there are few differences between the two that will affect you at this early stage, so either choice will suffice. Plus, once you have learned one, it is not too difficult to learn the other. In general, if you are just starting to learn Python, go with Python 3. It is a well-known better version as there are added features, along with plenty of bug fixes and a few refinements. However, Python 2 has much more support from third-party libraries. If you know you will need to use a library that has not been ported to version 3 yet, then it may be best to start with Python 2. Nonetheless, Python 2 was released in the year 2000, and has since reached its ends of life on January 1, 2020. So, this entire course will focus on Python 3 only, which is currently in active development, in terms of gaining new features and functionality. That said, most of the examples will work fine with either version, since many of the features and the updates added to Python 3, were also added to Python 2. How do I get Python? Installing Python on Windows is a slightly longer process, when compared to installing Python on Linux. In Linux, it is as easy as running a command, and having it set up. With Windows or macOS, it takes a slightly different route. To get started working with Python 3, you will need to have access to the Python interpreter. Fortunately, there are several common ways to accomplish this. Regardless of your operating system, Python can be obtained from the Python Software Foundation website itself, at python.org. Typically, that involves downloading the appropriate installer, for your operating system, Windows, Linux or macOS. Run it on your machine, then follow the instructions, so that you can properly install Python, and set up your environment. On Windows, you need to be sure to check the box that says, Add Python 3 to Path, so you can ensure that the interpreter will be placed in your execution path. Otherwise, you won't be able to call Python. But there are also multiple alternatives, depending on your platform. On Linux, it provides a package manager that can be run to install Python. On macOS, the best way to install Python 3 involves installing a package manager, called Homebrew. Another option, if you are using Windows 10, is to use a feature called the Windows Subsystem for Linux, WSL, which allows you to run a Linux environment, directly in Windows, and without the overhead of a virtual machine. On mobile operating systems, like Android and iOS, you can install apps that provide a Python programming environment, like Pythonista. This can be a great way to practice your coding skills, on the go. Alternatively, there are also several websites that allow you to access a Python interpreter online, without installing anything on your computer, at all. If you feel concerned about downloading Python onto your computer, or you just cannot do that for some reasons, then you are in luck. The Python Software Foundation offers an interactive Python shell, from Python Anywhere. You do not need to install it to use it, and it can be accessed on python.org/shell. Many other alternatives are, Python Anywhere, repl.it, and so on. Python Interactive Shell. Now that you have downloaded and installed Python, let's do a quick sanity check, to ensure everything is correctly set up, ready to watch the next video, and practice for hours. Open the Python's built-in Integrated Development and Learning Environment, IDLE, also known as the Interactive Python Shell. It is one of the mediums of communication, between the Python interpreter, and you. To do so, just open your terminal and type Python, if you only have one version of Python installed. If multiple versions of Python already exist, you may have to manually run Python 3. The interactive Python shell should open, and your command prompt, or terminal window, should look similar to this. You may not get the first couple of lines exactly as shown above, since everyone has different computers, versions, and even builds. As you have probably guessed, the interpreter tells us the Python version, date of build, the compiler used to build it, the computer's architecture, and the operating system. This information is important for debugging. And it is very useful, for checking Python's version. The most important thing, that you will need to remember, are those three greater than signs. They symbolize a prompt, that asks you for some input. Since this prompt is shown in a few examples, you will need to remember that it is not some special keyword, or thing you would need to type on a daily basis. While you are still in the interactive Python shell, you might as well run your first line of code. Print, learning Python with Digital Academy is fun. Once you typed enter, your code is being executed and interpreted, then you should see, learning Python with Digital Academy is fun. As you can see, a new line without the prompt, is output. Another important thing to know, is that the prompt changes to three periods, if you enter a command with indentations, since the Python interpreter is expecting more input. Overall, you will need to be careful not to mistake the prompt, for actual Python code. And that's it. Congratulations. You have just written your first Python program. Each time you entered a line, Python immediately executed the statement, displaying the value between the quotes. Once you are done, you can type exit or quit to leave the interactive Python shell. You can even use the keyboard shortcuts keys, Ctrl plus D, then press Enter. Python script. You will eventually find it tedious to retype programs into your shell, line by line. Like other interpreted programming languages, you can store and execute Python code, from a file. There are two main types of Python files, plain text, and bytecode files. Plain text files are simple files that you can create and edit, with just a simple plain text editor. For instance, Notepad, Notepad++, or Python's Integrated Development Environment. The other type of file, bytecode files, are compiled Python files. Don't worry about this type of file for now, which will be discussed later on in this course. A Python script file name ends with the extension, py, and will be executable when you execute the script by itself, on most operating systems. Create a file called, hello.py, and write the following code into it. Now, run the script by either clicking on it, or by running it from your system's shell. The script should print, hello world, from a Python script, and, press enter to continue, then it should pause, until you press the enter key. Congratulations, you got your first Python script to work. Integrated Development Environment. IDLE, or Integrated Development and Learning Environment, is the default IDE, that comes when you install Python. Writing Python code using IDLE or even the Python shell is great for simple things, but those tools quickly turn larger programming projects into frustrating pits of despair. Using an IDE, or even just a good dedicated code editor, makes coding fun, but which one is best for you? An IDE, or Integrated Development Environment, is a program dedicated to software development. As the name implies, IDEs integrate several tools, specifically designed for software development, which usually include an editor designed to handle code, syntax highlighting, indentation and auto-completion, build, execution, and debugging tools, some form of source control. Most IDEs support many different programming languages, and contain many more features. They can, therefore, be very large and take time to download and install. You may also need advanced knowledge to use them properly. In contrast, a dedicated code editor can be as simple as a text editor, with syntax highlighting, but also code formatting capabilities. Most good code editors can execute code and control a debugger. The very best ones interact with source control systems as well. Compared to an IDE, a good dedicated code editor is usually smaller and quicker, but it is often less feature-rich. So what things do we really need in a coding environment? Feature lists vary from app to app, but there are a core set of features that makes coding easier. Debugging support, syntax highlighting, automatic code formatting, saving and reloading code files, running code from within the environment. Of course, there are lots of other features you might want, like source code control, an extension model, build and test tools, language help, and so on. But the above list is what I would see as the core features that a very good editing environment should support. With these features in mind, let's take a look at some general purpose tools you can use for Python development. Vim, Atom, Notepad++, PyCharm, New Emacs, Sublime Text, Visual Studio, Eclipse plus PyDev. With that said, you now have multiple IDEs to select from. Please, tell me in the comments, which one is best for you? In this new video, you will discover the variables and data types in Python. So, let's play this video. Now that you know how to interact with the Python interpreter, and execute Python code, it is time to dig into the basic data types, in Python. Data types are the classification or categorization of data items. It represents the kind of value that tells what operations can be performed on a particular data. Thus, every value in Python has a data type. Since everything is an object in Python, data types are actually classes, and variables are instances object of these classes. Consequently, there are multiple data types in Python. Some of the most basic data types built into Python are numeric, string, and Boolean types. Others are part of the collections, tuples, lists, dictionaries, and sets. Mutable, immutable objects. When choosing a data or collection type, it is useful to understand the properties of that type. Choosing the right type for a particular data set could mean an increase in efficiency or in security. In fact, data objects of these types are stored in a computer's memory for processing. Some of these values can be modified during processing, but contents of others cannot be altered once they are created in the memory. Number values, strings, and tuple are immutable, which means their contents cannot be altered after creation. On the other hand, collection of items in a list or dictionary object can be modified. It is possible to add, delete, insert, and even rearrange items. Hence, they are mutable objects. Are you wondering what data type you should use? Don't worry, by the end of this tutorial, you will be familiar with what objects of these types look like and how to represent them. Numerical data types. In Python, numeric data type represent the data which has numeric value. Numeric value can be integer or floating numbers, even complex numbers. These values are redefined as int, float and complex class in Python. We can use the type function to know which class a variable or a value belongs to. And the isInstance function to check if an object belongs to a particular class. You can convert from one type to another with the int, float, and complex methods. Integers. This value is represented by int class. It contains positive or negative whole numbers without fraction or decimal. In Python 3, integers can be of any length, it is only limited by the amount of memory your system has, as are all things, but beyond that an integer can be as long as you need it to be. Python interprets a sequence of decimal digits without any prefix to be a decimal number. But the following strings can be prepended to an integer value, to indicate a base other than 10. floating point numbers. This value, represented by float class, designates a floating point number. It is a real number, with the floating point representation, and is specified with a decimal point. Optionally, the character e, followed by a positive or negative integer, may be appended, to specify the scientific notation. This representation is accurate up to 15 decimal places. Complex numbers. Complex numbers, represented by complex class, is written in the form, real part, plus, imaginary part, j. It is stored internally, using either rectangular or Cartesian coordinates. It can be very useful if you are studying or working with mathematical functions, or in engineering. For example, 2 plus 3j. Boolean. Python 3 provides a Boolean data type. Objects of Boolean type may have one of two values, true or false. In programming, you often need to know if an expression is true or false. You can evaluate any expression in Python, and get one of these two answers. For instance, when you compare two values, the expression is evaluated, then Python returns the Boolean answer. The same behavior occurs when you run a condition in an if statement. Python also has many built-in functions that returns a Boolean value, like the isInstance function, which can be used to determine if an object is of a certain data type. You will learn more about evaluation of objects in the Boolean context when you encounter logical operators in the upcoming tutorial on operators and expressions in Python. Strings. The string type in Python is represented by str class. Strings are immutable, which means that their content cannot be altered after their creation. Like many other popular programming languages, strings in Python are arrays of bytes, which represents Unicode characters. However, Python does not have a character data type. A single character is also considered as a string, with a length of 1. We denote or declare the string values inside single quotes, or double quotes. Hello is the same as hello. Multi-line strings can be denoted using triple quotes. Like list and tuple, slicing operator can be used with strings. To access the values in a string, we use the indexes and square brackets. Python also has a set of built-in methods that you can use on strings: strip, lower, upper, replace, split, among so many others. Lists. Now that you have understood numbers and strings, let's go through the relatively more complex data types. A list is one of the most used data type in Python, and is very flexible. It is a collection of items, which is ordered, and mutable. Which means that values of a list can be altered, even after its creation. All the elements in a list are indexed according to a definite sequence. The indexing of a list is done with 0 being the first index. Each element in the list has its own place, which allows duplicating of elements. Lists in Python are just like the arrays, declared in other languages. All the items in a list do not need to be of the same type, which makes one of the most powerful tool in Python. Declaring a list is pretty straightforward. Items, separated by commas, are enclosed within square brackets. A single list may contain data types like integers, strings, as well as objects. Lists in Python are ordered, and have a definite count. You can use the slicing operator to access and extract an item from a list, by referring to the index number. Dictionaries. Dictionary in Python is an unordered and indexed collection of values, used to store data. Unlike other data types, that hold only single value as an element, dictionary holds key, value pair. Key value is provided in the dictionary to make it more optimized for retrieving data. It is generally used when you have a huge amount of data, since you must know the key to retrieve the value, but not the other way around. In Python, a dictionary can be created by placing a sequence of elements within curly braces. Dictionary can also be created by the built-in function, dict. Values in a dictionary can be of any data type, and can be duplicated, whereas keys cannot be repeated. Each key-value pair is separated by a colon, whereas each entry is separated by a comma. Note, dictionary keys are case-sensitive. Same name but different cases of key will be treated distinctly. Tuples. Tuple is an ordered collection of Python objects, much like a list. The sequence of values stored in a tuple can be of any type, and they are indexed by integers, which allows duplicate members. The important difference between a list and a tuple is that tuples are immutable. Tuples, once created, cannot be modified. Tuples are used to write protect data, and are usually faster than list, as it cannot change dynamically. In Python, tuples are represented by tuple class, and created by placing sequence of values separated by comma, with or without the use of parentheses for grouping of data. Tuples can contain any number of elements, and of any data type, like strings, integers, list, etc. You can use the slicing operator to extract items, but cannot change values. Sets. In Python, set is an unordered collection of data type that is iterable, mutable, and has unique elements. The order of elements in a set is undefined, though it may consist of various elements. The advantage of using a set, as opposed to a list, is that it has a highly optimized method for checking whether a specific element is contained in the set. Set is defined by curly braces, with unique values, which are separated by commas. You can perform multiple set operations, like union and intersection on two sets. Since sets are unordered collection, indexing has no meaning. Hence the slicing operator does not work. Conversion between data types. In Python, data types are used to classify one particular type of data, determining the values that you can assign to the type, and the operations you can perform on it. Nonetheless, there are few times you need to convert values between types in order to manipulate values in a different way. For example, you may need to concatenate numeric values with strings, or represent decimal places in numbers that were initialized as integer values. As you have seen along the previous examples, you can get the data type of any object by using the type function and the isInstance function to check whether an object belongs to a particular class. You also have multiple constructors for each one of the data types in Python. You can simply use these constructors to use the specified data type. Or, you can change a data type to another one using these constructors. Basically, type casting is the process of changing one data type into another. Using these constructors, you can use various data types with the functionality of the other. Suppose you declare the list mentioned in the example as a tuple in a program. It will become immutable for that particular operation. Similarly, we can use other constructors as well. In this tutorial, you have learned about the built-in data types that Python provides. Head to the next tutorial and learn about Python variables. In this entire new video, you will now discover syntax and variables in Python. Please, do not forget to smash that like button, for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us, and providing new free content, once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. You might have produced a, Hello, World, program, in your chosen programming language. It is all very well, but quite limited, right? More complex programs need a way of labeling data with a name, so it can be referenced later. This has the rather wonderful side effect of making computer code easier to read. Nonetheless, there are a certain rules and regulations we have to follow while writing a variable. Let's take a look at the variable definition to understand how we declare a variable in Python. Variable definition. In a programming language, a variable is a memory location. Think of a variable as a name attached to a particular object. Variables are like containers for storing data values. The value that you have stored into this container may change in the future, according to the specifications. Variable declaration. In Python, variables do not need to be defined or declared in advance with any particular type, as is the case in many other programming languages. Variables can even change type after they have been set. A variable is created as soon as a value is assigned to it, and then you can start using it. Assignment is done with a single equals sign. This is read or interpreted as n is assigned the value 300. Once this is done, n can be used in a statement or expression, and its value will be substituted. Later, if you change the value of n and use it again, the new value will be substituted instead. Python also allows chained assignment, which makes it possible to assign the same value to multiple variables. The chained assignment above assigns 300 to the variables a, b, and c simultaneously. Object references. What is actually happening when you make a variable assignment? This is an important question in Python, because the answer differs somewhat from what you would find in many other programming languages. Python is a highly object-oriented language. In fact, virtually every item of data in a Python program is an object of a specific type or class. This point will be reiterated many times over the course of these tutorials. Consider this code. When presented with the statement print 300, the interpreter does the following steps. Creates an integer object, gives it the value 300, displays it to the console. You can see that an integer object is created using the built-in type function. A Python variable is a symbolic name that is a reference or pointer to an object. Once an object is assigned to a variable, you can refer to the object using that name. But the data itself is still contained within the object. For example, this assignment creates an integer object with the value 300 and assigns the variable n to point to that object. The following code verifies that n points to an integer object. Now consider the following statement. What happens when it is executed? Python does not create another object. It simply creates a new symbolic name or reference, m, which points to the same object that n points to. Next, suppose you do this. Now Python creates a new integer object with the value 400, and m becomes a reference to it. Lastly, suppose this statement is executed next. Now Python creates a string object with the value foo and makes n reference that. There is no longer any reference to the integer object 300. It is now orphaned, and there is no way to access it. Tutorials in this series will occasionally refer to the lifetime of an object. An object's life begins when it is created, at which time at least one reference to it is created. During an object's lifetime, additional references to it may be created, and references to it may be deleted as well. An object stays alive as long as it has at least one reference to it. When the number of references to an object drops to zero, it is no longer accessible. At that point, its lifetime is over. Python will eventually notice that it is inaccessible and reclaim the allocated memory, so it can be used for something else. In computer lingo, this process is referred to as garbage collection. Object identity. In Python, every object that is created is given a number that uniquely identifies it. It is guaranteed that no two objects will have the same identifier during any period in which their lifetimes overlap. Once an object's reference count drops to zero and it is garbage collected, then its identifying number becomes available and may be used again. The built-in Python function id returns an object's identifier. Using this function, you can verify that two variables point to the same object, indeed. After the assignment m equals n, m and n both point to the same object, confirmed by the fact that id m and id n return the same number. Once m is reassigned to 400, m and n point to different objects with different identities. Variable names and syntax. The examples you have seen so far have used short variable names. But the truth is that variable names can be more descriptive. In fact, it is usually beneficial if they are, because it makes the purpose of the variable more evident at first glance. At least you can tell from the name what the value of the variable is supposed to represent. Officially, variable names in Python can be any length and can consist of uppercase and lowercase letters, digits, and the underscore character. An additional restriction is that, although variable name can contain digits, the first character of a variable name cannot be one. Moreover, variables' names are case-sensitive, which means that age, and age are three different variables. For example, which of the following variable names are valid? You may have guessed right. If not, just play back and refer to the previous 5 rules, or even the style guide for Python code, also known as PEP 8, which contains naming conventions that list suggested standards for names of different object types. There is nothing stopping you from creating multiple different variables in the same program with the same name. But it is probably ill-advised. It would certainly be likely to confuse anyone trying to read your code, and even you yourself, after you had been away from it a while. Thus, it is worthwhile to give a variable a name that is descriptive enough to make clear what it is being used for. You will see later that variables are not the only things that can be given names. Actually, you can also name functions, classes, modules, and so on. The rules that apply to variable names also apply to identifiers. Reserved keywords. There is one more restriction on identifier names. The Python language reserves a small set of keywords that designate special language functionality. No object can have the same name as a reserved word. In Python 3, there are currently 33 reserved keywords, as described in this table. You can see this list anytime by typing help keywords to the Python interpreter. Reserved words are case sensitive and must be used exactly as shown. They are all entirely lowercase, except for false, none, and true. Trying to create a variable with the same name as any reserved word results in an error, syntax error. Variable types and scope. In many programming languages, variables are statically typed. That means a variable is initially declared to have a specific data type, and any value assigned to it during its lifetime must always have that type. Variables in Python are not subject to this restriction. In Python, a variable may be assigned a value of one type, and then later reassigned a value of a different type. If you are interested in learning basic and advanced data types in Python, please check out the suggested video. Being able to reassign a value into a variable can be very useful. Throughout the course of a program, you may need to accept user-generated values into already initialized variables, or may have to change the assignment to something you previously defined. Variable scope. If you are familiar with Python, or any other programming languages, you will certainly know that variables need to be defined before they can be used in your program. Depending on how and where it was defined, a variable will have to be accessed in different ways. Not all variables are accessible from all parts of your program. And not all variables exist for the same amount of time. Where a variable is accessible and how long it exists depend on how it is defined. We call the part of a program where a variable is accessible its scope. And the duration for which the variable exists its lifetime. Some variables are defined globally, others locally. This means that a variable referring to an entity in a certain part of a program may refer to something different in another part of the program, even at different points in time. Thus, if you define a variable at the top of your script, it will be a global variable. This means that it is accessible from anywhere in your script, including from a class defined in the same module, or both inside and outside of a function. On the other hand, a variable which is defined inside a function is local to that function. It is accessible from the point at which it was defined until the end of the function. And it exists for as long as the function is executing. For instance, the parameter names in the function definition behave like local variables. But they contain the values that we pass into the function when we call it. When you use the assignment operator equals inside a function, its default behavior is to create a new local variable, unless a variable with the same name is already defined in the local scope. Normally, when you create a variable inside a function, that variable is local and can only be used inside that function. If you create a variable with the same name inside a function, the global variable with the same name will remain as it was and will keep its original value. Thus, in order to create a global variable inside a function, you can use the global reserved keyword. Also, use the global keyword if you want to change a global variable inside a function, but that was declared outside. This tutorial covered the basics of Python variables, including object references and identity, as well as naming of Python identifiers. You should now have a good understanding of some of Python's data types, and know how to create variables that reference objects of those data types. In the next video, you will discover and may learn how to combine data objects into expressions, involving various conditions and operators. So, do not waste any minute, and join us in the next episode. In this new video, you will now discover multiple operators in Python, and how to use them. Please, do not forget to smash that like button for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us and providing new free content once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Python language is one of the most popular programming languages. Whilst learning Python is seemingly easy, there are certain core concepts that must be mastered before moving on with various applications of Python. Operators in Python are one of the core fundamental concepts. Therefore, this video will help you understand the different types of operators in Python, so let's stick around and watch until the end of this video. What is an operator? Operators in Python are special symbols you will use for operations between two values, or variables. The values that an operator acts on are called operands. And the output varies according to the type of operator you have used in the operation. Suppose if you want to perform addition of two variables or values, you can use the addition operator for this special operation. The values in the operands can be variable, or any data type that you have in Python. Here is an example. In this case, the plus operator adds the operands a and b together. An operand can be either a literal value, or a variable that references an object. A sequence of operands and operators, like a plus b, is called an expression. Python supports many operators for combining data objects into expressions. These operators are explored in the next section. Types of operators. Depending upon the type of operations you want to perform, there are 7 types of operators in Python. Arithmetic operators. Assignment operators. Comparison operators. Logical operators. Bitwise operators. Identity operators. Membership operators. Arithmetic operators. Arithmetic operators are used to perform common mathematical operations in Python, like addition, subtraction and multiplication, but also division, among so many others. Below are the arithmetic operators with symbols, and their meaning. These are simple mathematical operators that you will use while doing an arithmetic operation in Python. Apart from these 4 basic arithmetic operators, you also have exponential, modulus and floor division operators. Please note that the result of standard division is always a float, even if the dividend is evenly divisible by the divisor. Whereas the fractional portion of floor division is truncated off, leaving only the integer portion. Assignment operators. Assignment operators are used to assign values to the variables or any other object in Python. For instance, x equals 5 is a simple assignment operator that assigns the value 5 on the right to the variable x on the left. There are also multiple compound operators in Python, like x plus equals 5, that adds to the variable and later assigns the same. Therefore, this is the equivalent of x equals x plus 5. Comparison operators. Next, let's move forward to the next operator, comparison operators, which are used to compare two values. Since it either returns true or false, comparison operators are typically used in Boolean contexts, like conditional and loop statements, in order to direct program flow, as you will see later, in the upcoming video. Following are the comparison operators that we have in Python, greater than, lesser than, equal to, and not equal to. Logical operators. Logical operators, and, or, and, not, operators are used to compare two conditional statements. The logical operators modify and join together expressions, evaluated in Boolean context, to create more complex conditions. When you use the AND operator, the expression will return true, if both operands are true. Whereas using the OR operator will only result in true, if at least one of the operands is true. Finally, the NOT operator will only give true, if the Boolean expression as the operand is false. Bitwise operators. Let's move forward and look at bitwise operators, which are similar to logical operators but they treat operands as sequences of binary digits, and operate on them bit by bit. For example, 5 is 101 in binary form, and 7 is 111. When you perform a OR operation on these operands, it will give you the output 7, 111, in binary form, since you performed a logical operation on each bit of the numbers, one at a time. This is exactly the same when you perform the AND operation, but using the appropriate logical operation, bit by bit. Finally but no least, there is another bitwise operator in Python, called XOR. It performs the exclusive or operation on each bit of the numbers, and will return true only if one bit is true, not the both of them. Apart from these three operators, you have two more bitwise operators, which are right shift and left shift operators. What basically happens when this type of operand is used? First, the value is converted into its binary representation. Then, you will have to specify which type of shift you want to perform, using two greater than signs, or two lesser than signs. Finally, once you have done that, you will have to specify the number of bits you want to shift. Then, the binary output will shift towards the direction you chose, left or right, for the number of bits you specified. Python language offers some special type of operators, like the identity operator or the membership operator. They are described in the next sections, with a few examples for each one of them. Identity operators. Identity operators, isn't as not, are used to compare two values, or variables, not if they are equal, but if they are actually the same object, located on the same part of the memory. Hence, the two variables that are equal does not necessarily imply that they are identical, with the same identity. Here is an example of two objects that are equal, but not identical. X and Y both refer to objects whose value is 5, they are equal. But they do not reference the same object, as you can verify, X and Y do not have the same identity, and X as Y returns false. You saw previously that when you make an assignment like x equals y, Python merely creates a second reference to the same object, and you could confirm that fact with the id function. You can also confirm it using the is operator. Unsurprisingly, the opposite of is not. Let's move forward to the last type of operators. Membership operators. Membership operators, in and not in, are used to test whether a value, or variable, is found in a sequence, string, list, tuple, set or dictionary. Following are the membership operators that we have in Python, and return a Boolean. For instance, if a value 3 is found in the list x equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the statement 3 in x will return true. On the other hand, the statement 3 not in x will return false, since 3 is not an element of this list. Operator precedence. All operators that the language supports are assigned a precedence. In an expression, all operators of highest precedence are performed first. Once those results are obtained, operators of the next highest precedence are performed. So it continues until the expression is fully evaluated. And any operators of equal precedence are performed in left to right order. Here is the order of precedence of the Python operators you have seen so far, from lowest to highest. Operators at the top of the table have the highest precedence, and those at the bottom of the table have the lowest. Any operators in the same row of the table have equal precedence. Operator precedence can be overridden using parentheses. Expressions in parentheses are always performed first, and before expressions that are not parenthesized. There is nothing wrong with making liberal use of parentheses, even when they are not necessary to change the order of evaluation. In fact, it is considered good practice, because it can make the code more readable, and it relieves the reader of having to recall operator precedence from memory. You now have a complete overview of various operators in Python, but keep in mind that, when two operators share an operand, the operator with the higher precedence goes first, so are expressions in parentheses. In this tutorial, you discovered multiple operators that Python supports, so you can combine objects into expressions. You should now have quite a good understanding of the assignment, logical and comparison operators. This way, you are fully prepared to explore conditions in much more detail, so you can now control the execution flow of your Python program, if-else statements, which will be covered in the very next upcoming video. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. In this brand new video, you will now discover conditional statements in Python, its syntax and how to properly use logical and comparison operators, so you can control the execution flow of your program. Please, do not forget to smash that like button, for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us, and providing new free content, once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Everything you have seen so far, has consisted of sequential execution, in which statements are always performed, one after the next, and exactly in the order you specified, explicitly. But the world is often more complicated than that. Frequently, a program needs to skip over some statements, execute a series of statements repetitively, or even choose between alternate sets of statements to execute. And this is where the core concept of control structure comes in, so you can control which instructions are executed in your program. Definition. In programming languages, most of the time you want to control the execution flow of your program, since you want to execute some set of statements only if the given condition is satisfied. And a different set of statements when it is not satisfied. Please note that conditional structures are also known as decision-making statements. A decision is when a program has more than one choice of actions, depending on a variable's value. In the real world, you commonly must evaluate information around you, and then choose one course of action or another, based on what you observe. Right? For instance, think of a traffic light. When it is green, you continue your drive. When you see the light turn yellow, you reduce your speed, and when it is red, you stop. These are logical decisions that depend on the value of the traffic light. Luckily, when your application needs to make such decisions in Python, the if statement is how you perform this sort of decision making. And it allows conditional execution of a statement, or a group of statements, based on the value of a Boolean expression. If statements. In order to write useful programs, we almost always need the ability to test conditions, and change the behavior of the program, accordingly. Fortunately, conditional statements give us this ability. If statements are one of the most commonly used conditional statements, in many programming languages. It decides whether certain statements need to be executed, or not. If statement checks for a given condition, when the Boolean expression is true, the set of code inside the if block is executed. On the other hand, when the expression is false, the set of code inside the if block is skipped over, and not executed at all. Now, let's take a look at its syntax. The Boolean expression after the if statement is called the condition. A few things to keep in mind about if statements are. 1. The colon is significant and required. It separates the header of the compound statements from the body. 2. The line after the colon must be properly indented. In Python, it is standard to use 4 spaces for indenting. 3. All lines indented the same amount after the colon will be executed whenever the Boolean expression is true. 1 line if statements. It is customary to write if on one line, and indented on the following line. But, if you only have a unique line of code to be executed, rather than multiple lines in the code following the condition, you can place it all in the same line. This is not a rule, but just a common practice amongst coders. Thus, both of the following are functionally equivalent. If expression, statement, on the following line. Or, if expression, statement, on the same line. There can even be more than one statement on the same line, separated by semicolons. But what does it mean? If the expression is true, execute all of the statements. Otherwise, do not execute any of them. Here is an example. If expression, statement 1, statement 2, statement n, etc. The Python pass statement. Occasionally, it is useful to have a section with no statements, usually as a place keeper, where you will eventually put a block of code that you have not implemented yet. Because Python uses indentation instead of delimiters, it is not possible to specify an empty block. If you introduce an if statement, something has to come after it, either on the same line, or indented on the following line. To keep the interpreter happy in any situation where a statement is syntactically required, you can use the pass statement, which does nothing except act as a placeholder. Here is an example. If true, pass. Print after pass. This Python code will only print after pass, since the pass statement is used inside the if statement. Example. Now that you know how to check whether a condition is true or not, let's get to the practice. For example, let's say you are recording the score for a certain course. The total score is 100, with 50 points for the theoretical work, and 50 for practical. You want to display an error message or warning, if the score exceeds 100. How would you proceed? Let's declare 2 variables, and affect a value to each one of them, score theory equals 40, score practical equals 45. Now, let's write a conditional statement, to check whether the total score, which is the addition of these 2 variables, is greater than 100. If score theory plus score practical greater than 100, print invalid score, please check the input. And here you are, you just wrote your first if statement that will evaluate the total score and print a warning message when the input is invalid. If else statements. You know how to use an if statement to conditionally execute a single statement or a block of several statements. It is now time to find out what else you can do to control the execution flow of your program. Sometimes, you want to evaluate a condition and take one path if it is true, so that one thing or more can happen, but specify an alternative path when it is not, and something else happens. This is accomplished with an else clause, which executes a statement in case all the tested expressions are false, in the default case. To understand the control flow of an if-else statement, take a look at the flow chart of how the execution takes place. If expression, statements. Else, statements. An if expression is followed by an indented block of statements. If the expression is true, the first block of statements is executed, then the second is skipped. But, after the if statement, there is an optional else statements which is followed by another indented block of statements. When the if expression is false, the first block of statements is skipped, then, the second executed instead. There is no limit on the number of statements that can appear under the two clauses of an if-else statement, but there has to be at least one statement in each block. Either way, execution then resumes after the second block. Also note that both suites of statements are defined by indentation, as described earlier. Example. Great. Let's get back and say you wanted to go a step further, in the previous example. Imagine you wanted to display a statement, when the total score was actually within the range, less than 100. 'Cause this is exactly when the if-else statement would help. When recording the score for a certain coursework, you want to add, together, the points for the theory part, and also the practical part to get the total score. If the total score is greater than 100, you want to display a warning message. And if it is less than 100, display a score valid message. Here is a solution to this problem. Declare two variables, score theory equals 40, score practical equals 45. Then write the if-else statement to check whether the total score is valid, or print a warning message when it is not. If score theory plus score practical greater than 100. Print, please check the input, score exceeds total possible score. Else, print, score validated, your total is, score theory plus score practical. If, ELIF, else statements. Sometimes, there are more than two possibilities, so you need more than two branches. Fortunately, there is one more conditional statement in Python, which is used to test out more expressions, in order to optimize and increase the efficiency of your code. One way to express such a computation, is called, a chained conditionals, or else if. Let's take a look at its syntax, to understand how you can declare an else if statement block, in Python. If expression 1, statements. ELIF expression 2, statements. ELIF expression 3, statements. Etc. Else, statements. Each condition is checked in order. If the first is false, the next is checked. If the second is false, the next is checked, and so on. If one of them is true, the corresponding branch executes, and the statement ends. Even if more than one condition is true in the following statements, only the first true branch will execute. There is no limit of the number of else if statements, but only a single, and optional, final else statement is allowed. And it must be the last branch in the statement. If an else clause is not included, and all the conditions are false, then none of the blocks will be executed. Example. Let's get back to our example, and imagine a case where one of these scores exceed 50, but the total is still less than 100. What do you think would happen then? I bet you guessed it right? This code will output, score validated, your total is, 95. Although this is wrong, since you know that the maximum limit for individual scores, for theory or practical, should not exceed 50. How can you represent this in Python code, using if-elif-else statement? One way, is to check whether the individual scores, for theory and practical, do not exceed 50. Here is an example. Let's declare the same two variables, but one of them with a value greater than 50. Score theory equals 60, score practical equals 20. You will now check whether the limit for individual scores, which is 50. If score theory greater than 50, print, please check the input score for theory. ELIF score practical greater than 50, print, please check the input score for practical. Else, print, score validated, your total is score theory plus score practical. And here you are. You are now able to check whether an expression is met. And evaluate another condition, when the first one is false. Then, finally, have a default case, when none of them is true. Nested conditionals. When you have an if statement inside another if statement, this is called nesting, in the programming world. It does not have to always be a simple if statement, but you could use the concept of if else and even if else statements, all of them combined, to form a more complex structure, and check multiple conditions, in a given code. Although the indentation of the statements makes the structure apparent, nested conditionals become difficult to read, very quickly. In general, it is a good idea to avoid them, as much as you can, since indentation is the only way to figure out what is the level of nesting. An if statement, present inside another if statement, which is present inside another if statements itself, and so on, is pretty difficult to read, right? But, let's have a look at one example, of nested conditionals. If expression 1, statements. Else, if expression 2, statements. Else, statements. The outer conditional contains two branches. The second branch, else, contains another if statement, which has two branches of its own. Those two branches could contain conditional statements, as well. You see now, how quickly this could become difficult to read, and even code yourself. Conditional expressions. Python supports one additional decision-making entity, called, a conditional expression, or even ternary operator. In its simplest form, the syntax of the conditional expression is as follows. Expression 1, if, conditional expression, else, expression 2. This is quite different from the if statement forms, listed earlier. Because it is not a control structure, that directs the flow of execution of your program. Instead, it acts more like an operator, that defines an expression. In the example, this conditional expression is evaluated first. If it is true, the expression evaluates to expression 1. And if it is false, then it evaluates to the expression 2. Notice the non-obvious order, the middle expression is evaluated first, and based on that result, one of the expressions or values, on the ends, is returned. As you may have guessed, a common use of the conditional expression is for variable assignment. Example. Here are some other examples that will, hopefully, help you clarify this concept, of conditional expressions. In the very first example, raining has a Boolean value of false. Thus, the expression, if not raining, is true, and results in returning the left value of the conditional expression, which is beach. Consequently, it will print, let's go to the beach. On the other hand, when raining has a Boolean value of true, the conditional expression is false, which results in, printing out, let's go to the library. Okay? Let's pause this video and analyze the other examples, if you want to. Great, it is now time to practice, so, open your favorite code editor, and get to your keyboards. In this tutorial, you have learned about the conditional statements, in Python. These are the statements which alter and control the flow of execution, in your program. All of these concepts are crucial, to develop more complex Python code. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In the next two tutorials, you will discover two new control structures, the while statement, and the for statement. These structures facilitate iteration, execution of a statement or block of statements, repeatedly, also known as loops. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. In this brand new video, you will now discover iterations in Python, using for and while loops, so you can improve the execution flow of your program. Please, do not forget to smash that like button, for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us, and providing new free content, once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Loops in Python are an efficient method for optimizing your code, and executing multiple statements. If the same block of code has to be executed, multiple times, over and over, you can put it into a loop, to perform multiple iterations, and get the same desired output. Consequently, it saves a lot of effort, and reduces complexity of the code, as well. Basically, there are two types of iteration, in programming languages. indefinite iteration, in which the code block executes, until some condition is met. This iteration is performed using while loops, and will be discussed in the very next upcoming video. And definite iteration, in which the number of repetitions is specified, explicitly, and in advance. This kind of iteration is performed using for loops, and will be discussed in the next section. For loops. The for statement in Python is a bit different from what you usually use in other programming languages. Rather than iterating over a numeric progression, Python's for statement iterates over the items of an iterable, strings, dictionaries, lists, tuples and sets, or any other iterable objects. For loops are traditionally used when you have a block of code which you want to repeat a fixed number of times. The Python for statement iterates over the members of a sequence, then executes the same block each time, and in order. Do not forget to contrast the for statement with the while loop, used when the condition needs to be checked for every single iteration, or to repeat a block of code, forever. Okay, but what does it look like? And how to control the execution flow of your program, using for loops? Let's move forward, and have a look at the syntax of the for statement. For var in sequence. Statement 1, statement 2, etc. Here is a simple declaration of for loop, in which the variable var takes the value of an item inside the sequence, and on each iteration. Loop executes all statements and it continues until we reach the last item of the sequence. The body of loop, which includes some statements, is separated from the rest of the code using indentation. This loop can be described entirely in terms of the concepts you have just learned about. Python does the following steps. Calls iter, to obtain an iterator for the iterable. Calls next, repeatedly, to obtain each item from the iterator. Executes the loop body, once for each item, and set the variable to the given item. Terminates the loop, when next, raises the stop iteration exception, then continues. Let's have a more practical and very simple example, so you can discover and understand how to properly use Python for loops, in your program. First, declare a list of strings, and add a few strings into this list. Colors equals red, green, blue, yellow. Then, you will iterate through this list using for statement, and print each item. For color in colors. Print color. Very simple, right? The execution will start and look for the first item in the sequence or iterable object. It will check whether it has reached the end of the sequence or not. After executing the statements in the block, it will look for the next item in the sequence. And the process will continue, over and over again, until the execution has reached the last item in the sequence. In the above example, the execution started from the first item in the list colors, and it went on until the execution has reached its last item, which is yellow. This is a very simple example of how you can use for loops, in Python. Of course, there are many other alternatives you can use, and go through any iterable object. Here is another example, when you want to iterate through every single character of a string, because a string is a list of character. Do you remember? My string equals Python. For letter in my string. Print letter. And here you are, you just wrote your first Python iteration, using for loops. This very simple code will iterate through a list, and print out every single item of that list. Was not that hard, right? Let's move forward to the next section. In each example you have seen so far, the entire body of the for loop is executed, on each iteration. It is all very well, but quite limited, right? Fortunately, Python provides two keywords, break and continue, that will terminate a loop iteration, prematurely. Break, in for loop. Break in Python is a flow control statement that is used to exit the execution, as soon as the break is encountered. The Python break statement immediately terminates a loop entirely. Consequently, the program execution then proceeds to the first statement, following the loop body. Let's understand how you can use a break statement in for loop, using an example. So, let's say you have a list with strings as items. You want to exit the loop using the break statement as soon as the desired string is encountered. In the above example, as soon as the loop encounters the space character, it will enter the if statement block where the break statement will exit the loop, straight away. Thus, it will only print digital. Did you get it? Then let's practice. It's your turn now. Suppose you have a list of colors, red, green, blue, yellow, and you want to print each color, but break the loop when it encounters blue. How would you proceed? What output would you get? Here is a solution. First, let's declare a list, in which you added all of the colors, red, green, blue, yellow. Then, iterate throughout this list, using for statement, for color in colors. It will create an iterator, and the variable color will get the next value, on each iteration, until the execution has reached the last item in the sequence. When it encounters the item, blue, you do not want to execute the code that comes next, but exit the loop, if color equals equals, blue, break. In all the other cases, as it would be with an else statement, you want to print the current color. As you may have guessed, the loop will print red, green, and stop, because the next item is blue. Congrats, you just wrote your first for loop, on your own. Great. Let's dig a little deeper, and suppose this time you do not want to exit the loop, but just skip the current iteration, and execute the rest of the iterations anyway, with the next items. Continue, in for loop. The Python continue statement, on the other hand, will immediately terminate the current loop iteration. The execution jumps to the top of the loop and re-evaluate the expression, to determine whether the loop will execute again, with the next iteration, or if it will terminate, and proceed to the first statement, following the loop, like it would, with the break reserved keyword you have seen before. Let's have a look at the same example you have seen, in the break statement. But, instead of break, you will now use the continue statement. Continue is also a control statement, but the only difference is that it will only skip the current iteration in the loop, continues with the next iteration, then executes the rest of the iterations anyway, until it reaches the last item of the sequence. In the above example, as soon as the loop encounters the item, blue, it will enter the if statement block, where the continue statement will skip the current item in the loop, then continues to the next iteration, with the item yellow. This will result in printing out red, green, and yellow, since blue has been skipped over. Good. But how can you execute some code, after for loop statement, and still keep your code clear? Else, in for loop. The common construct is to run a loop, and search for an item. If the item is found, we break out of the loop, using the break statement. There are two scenarios in which the loop may end. The first one is when the item is found and break is encountered. The second scenario is that the loop ends without encountering a break statement. Now we may want to know which one of these is the reason for a loop's completion. One method is to set a flag, and then check it, once the loop ends. Another is to use an optional else clause, at the end of for loop. The else clause will be executed, if the loop terminates naturally, through exhaustion of the iterable object. On the other hand, if the loop terminates prematurely, with break, the else clause will not be executed, at all. Here is the basic structure, of for else loop. First, let's assume you declared a list, with some colors inside. Now, you want to search for a specific item, which in that case, is the color blue. If you find it, you want to break this loop, then continue with the next statements after the loop. But, on the other hand, if you didn't find that item, you want to execute some code first. Then, and only then, execute the same code that if you found it, and proceed with the rest of your code. Nested for loop. Loops can be nested in Python, as they can with other programming languages. The program first encounters the outer loop, executing its first iteration. This first iteration triggers the inner, nested loop, which then runs to completion. Thus, the inner loop will be executed one time, for each iteration of the outer loop. Awesome. You are now able to write your own iterations, then repeat a block of code, until you have reached the last item of a list. But, in most cases, you would like to execute a group of statements, for a fixed number of times, right? Fortunately, Python provides a very simple way to repeat an action, for a specific number of times, the built-in function range, which generates a sequence of numbers, from 0 up to but not including a specified number. A range function has three parameters, which are, starting, ending and a step parameters. You can define each one of them as range, start, stop, step size. This function does not store all the values in memory, it would be inefficient. So, it remembers the start, stop, and step parameters, and generates the next number, on the go. Let's take a look at how range function can be used with for loop. For I in range 7, print I. In the above example, the sequence starts from 0 and ends at 6 because the ending parameter is 7 and is not included. The default step is 1, if not provided. Therefore, the for execution jumps one step for each new iteration and will result in printing out all the numbers from 0 through 6 included. As you may have noticed, the range function starts from 0 by default. But you can start the range at another number by specifying the start parameter. For instance, for I in range 2, 7, print I. This will result in printing out numbers from 2 through 6 included. You can even generate a range of negative numbers as well. For I in range, minus 5, 0, print I. This example will result in printing out numbers from minus 5 through minus 1, included, since the ending parameter is never included, remember. Finally but not least, the range increments by 1 its default behavior. But, you can specify a different increment, by specifying a step size parameter. Here is an example, for I in range, 2, 7, 2, print I. The sequence starts from 2 and ends at 6, because the ending parameter is 7 and the step is 2. Therefore, the for execution jumps 2 steps, after each iteration. And it will result in printing out the numbers 2, 4 and 6. Wow, that is a lot to take in, right? Fortunately for you, this is the last part of this tutorial. You have seen how to iterate through strings, lists or any other iterable objects. But, you still don't have any idea how to get their respective indexes? You can use the range function in for loops to iterate through a sequence of numbers. Plus, it can be combined with the len function to iterate through a sequence using indexing as follows. This way, you can get the exact position of the current item in the list. That is great. However, in most such cases, it is convenient to use the enumerate function, which results in the same output, but simplify the way you write your Python code. Indeed, the enumerate function will provide a tuple that you can then unpack to get both the index and the value of the current item. Here is an example with the exact same result. In this tutorial, you have learned about a new structure in Python, iterations, also known as loops. This is one of the statements which control the flow of execution in your program, and execute a block of code, repeatedly. All of these concepts are crucial to develop more advanced Python code, and reduce its complexity. In the next tutorial, you will discover another loop statement, the while structure. This structure also facilitates iteration and repeats a statement, or block of statements, till some condition is met. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In this brand new video, you will now discover iterations in Python, using for and while loops, so you can improve the execution flow of your program. Please, do not forget to smash that like button, for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us, and providing new free content, once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Definition: loops in Python are an efficient method for optimizing your code and executing multiple statements. If the same block of code has to be executed multiple times, over and over, you can put it into a loop to perform multiple iterations and get the same desired output. Consequently, it saves a lot of effort and reduces complexity of the code as well. Basically, there are two types of iteration in programming languages: definite iteration, in which the number of repetitions is specified explicitly and in advance. This kind of iteration is performed using for loops and has been discussed in the previous video. Indefinite iteration, in which the code block executes until some condition is met. This iteration is performed using while loops and will be discussed in the next section. While loops. The while statement in Python is a bit different from what you usually use in other programming languages. Rather than iterating over a numeric progression or over the items of an iterable, like strings, dictionaries, lists, tuples and sets, or any other iterable objects. While loops are traditionally used when you have a block of code which you want to repeat indefinitely, and as long as an expression is true or a particular condition is met. You generally use this loop when you do not know beforehand how many iterations are going to take place. Do not forget to contrast the while statement with the for loop used when you want to repeat a block of code for a fixed number of times. Okay, but what does it look like and how to control the execution flow of your program using while loops? Let's move forward and have a look at the syntax of the while statement. While condition, statement 1, statement 2, etc. Here is a simple declaration of while loop. First, he execution starts and checks whether the condition is true. When the condition is true, it enters the while loop and executes the indented statements inside the while loop. After one iteration, the condition is checked again. And this process continues until the condition evaluates to false. As soon as the condition is false, its execution skips the while loop and moves to the next following statements in the program. Please also note that Python interprets any non-zero value or non-empty container as true. Consequently, none, zero, and empty sequence will be interpreted as false. And if the condition is false at the start, the while loop will never be executed. Let's have a more practical and very simple example, so you can discover and understand how to properly use Python loops in your program. First, declare an integer I with the value of 6. Then, you will iterate and execute the block of code inside the while loop, which will print I and decrement the variable. Thus, on each iteration, this expression will be evaluated again, until it becomes false, or zero, in that specific case. If you are not used to decrement a variable with this syntax, variable minus equals 1, please check the suggested video on the operators, in Python. In the above example, the execution starts with the variable I equals 6. Then it tests whether the expression I is true, or I equals 0. As long as the condition is true, it will enter and execute the statements, inside the loop. Until it becomes false, then it will proceed with the statements, after the loop. It is a very simple example of how you can use while loops in Python. Of course, there are many other alternatives you can use, and go through any iterable object, as well. Here is another example, when you want to iterate through every single item of a list. First, let's declare a list of strings, and add a few strings to this list. Then, you will iterate through the list using while statement, and print each item. Very simple, right? The execution will start and check whether the expression is true, in that case if the list is not empty. Then, look for the first item in the sequence or any iterable object. After executing the statements in the block, which pop the current item into a variable and print it out, it will re-evaluate the condition, and the process will continue, over and over again, looks for the next item in the sequence, and print it out, until it reaches the last item of that list, yellow, and becomes empty. Did you get it? Here is a last example, when you want to iterate through every single character of a string, because a string is a list of characters. This code will print out every single character of my string, until the condition, letter different than exclamation point, evaluates to false, or if the opposite, letter equals exclamation point, becomes true. And here you are, you just wrote your first Python iteration, using while loops. Was not that hard? Let's move forward to the next section, so you can alter the behavior of your while loop, during its execution. In each example you have seen so far, the entire body of the while loop is executed on each iteration. It is all very well, but quite limited, right? Fortunately, Python provides two keywords, break and continue, which terminate the current loop iteration, prematurely, without even checking the test expression. Please note that break and continue work the same way with for loops, as with while loops. Now, let's take a look at how you can use these control statements. Break in while loop. Break in Python is a control flow statement that is used to exit the execution as soon as the break is encountered. The Python break statement immediately terminates a loop entirely. Consequently, the program execution then proceeds to the first statement following the loop body. Let's understand how you can use a break statement in while loop using an example. So, let's say you have a list with strings as items. You want to exit the loop using the break statement, as soon as the desired string is encountered. In the above example, as soon as the loop encounters the space character, it will enter the if statement block where the break statement will exit the loop, straight away. Thus, it will only print digital. Did you get it? Then let's practice, it's your turn now. Suppose you have a list of colors, red, green, blue, yellow, and you want to print each color, but break the loop when it encounters blue. How would you proceed? What output would you get? Here is a solution. First, let's declare a list, in which you added all of the colors, red, green, blue, yellow. Then, iterate throughout this list, using while statement, while colors. It will create an iterator, and the variable color will get the first value inside the list, on each iteration, until the execution has reached the last item in the sequence and the list becomes empty. When it encounters the item, blue, you do not want to execute the code that comes next, but exit the loop, if color equals equals blue, break. In all the other cases, as it would be with an else statement, you want to print out the current color. As you may have guessed, the loop will print red, green, and stop as soon as it has encountered item blue. Congrats, you just wrote your first while loop, on your own. Great. Let's dig a little deeper, and suppose this time you do not want to exit the loop, but just skip the current iteration, and execute the rest of the iterations anyway, with the next items. Continue, in while loop. The Python continue statement, on the other hand, will immediately terminate the current loop iteration. The execution jumps to the top of the loop and re-evaluate the expression, to determine whether the loop will execute again, with the next iteration, or if it will terminate and proceed to the first statement, following the loop, like it would, with the break reserved keyword you have seen before. Let's have a look at the same example you have seen, in the break statement. But, instead of break, you will now use the continue statement. Continue is also a control statement, but the only difference is that it will only skip the current iteration in the loop, continues with the next iteration, then executes the rest of the iterations anyway, until the while condition becomes false. In the above example, as soon as the loop encounters the item, blue, it will enter the if statement block, where the continue statement will skip the current item in the loop, then continues to the next iteration, with the item yellow. This loop will repeat until it reaches the last item of the sequence, and result in printing out red, green, and yellow, since blue has been skipped over. Good. But how can you execute some code, after the while loop statement, and still keep your code clear? Else, in while loop. The common construct is to run a loop, and search for an item. If the item is found, we break out of the loop, using the break statement. There are two scenarios in which the loop may end. The first one is when the item is found and break is encountered. The second scenario is that the loop ends naturally, without encountering a break statement. Now we may want to know which one of these is the reason for a loop's completion. One method is to set a flag, and then check it once the loop ends. Another is to use an optional else clause, at the end of a while loop. The else clause will be executed, if the loop terminates naturally, when the condition becomes false, or if it has been false since its beginning and it did not enter the loop body. On the other hand, if the loop terminates prematurely, with break, the else clause will not be executed, at all. Here is the basic structure, of a while else loop. First, let's assume you declared a list, with some colors inside. Now, you want to search for a specific item, which in that case, is the color blue. If you find it, you want to break this loop, then continue with the next statements, after the loop. But, on the other hand, if you didn't find that item, you want to execute some code first, then and only then, execute the same code that if you found it, and proceed with the rest of your code. As you may have guessed, the function not found in iterable, will never be called in this example, since the while loop will terminate prematurely, as soon as it encounters the item, blue. Infinite loop. Suppose you write a while loop that, theoretically, never ends. Sounds weird, right? Well, that kind of loop, also known as infinite loop, might be very useful in client-server programming, where the server needs to run continuously, so that the client programs can communicate with it, as, and when, required. As you may have understood, an infinite while loop executes infinite times, which means, theoretically, the execution never stops. This may come as a surprise, but it has its own advantages, and disadvantages, as well. Therefore, you must use it with caution, because of the possibility that this condition never resolves to a false value, and may never exit this infinite loop. Let's have a look at a more practical example. This program will run infinite iterations, unless you press Ctrl plus C, or put a break control statement in the loop. The condition within the while statement must eventually become false. Otherwise, the loop will execute forever, creating an infinite loop. Fortunately, you can safely implement an infinite loop in your program, using the break control statement that you have seen little bit earlier. This way, as soon as the condition is met, this break keyword will immediately interrupt the current iteration, exit the infinite loop, and proceed with the next statements, outside of the loop. In the above example, this code will run indefinitely, ask the user for a name, and exit the infinite loop as soon as it encounters stop. Otherwise, print out the name that the user typed in. In this tutorial, you have learned about a new structure, in Python, infinite iterations, also known as while loop. This is one of the statements which control the flow of execution in your program and will execute a block of code, repeatedly. You can also adapt the behavior of the while loop, using the two control statements, break, and continue. Plus, add an additional, else clause when you want to execute some code, only if the loop terminates naturally. All of these concepts are crucial, to develop more advanced Python code, and reduce its complexity. In the next tutorial, you will discover one of the most used data type, dictionary. This kind of data types is used when you want to store a pair of key, value, and access a value in a very efficient way, thanks to its key. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In this brand new video, you will now discover another data type, the list. Be sure to stick around, and watch until the end of this video, if you want to discover how you can, create a list, add and remove a few items, iterate through a list, seeking for and accessing a specific item, plus various built-in methods, that you can perform on lists. Please, do not forget to smash that like button, for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us, and providing new free content, once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Definition. Python offers a range of compound data types, often referred to as sequences. List is one of the most frequently used data types. In fact, list in Python is a collection of items, which is ordered. Indexed. Allows duplicate members. And is mutable, so it can be changed, once it has been created. Consequently, it is often used when you want to store an item, and then access it in a very particular order. The important properties of Python lists are as follows. Lists are ordered. Lists remember the order of items inserted. Accessed by index. Items in a list can be accessed, using an index. Lists can contain any sort of object. It can be numbers, strings, tuples, and even other, nested, lists. Lists are dynamic. You can change a list in place, add new items, and even delete or update existing items. Great! Now that you have understood what a list is, let's move forward and discover how to create a list in Python, but also what are all of the operations you can perform on it, in order to add, remove, or access an item, or even search for a specific item inside of this list. So, be sure to stick around, and watch the entire video. Creating a list. There are several ways to create a new list. In Python programming language, the simplest way to create a list is to enclose all the items, also known as elements, inside square brackets. And separate every item by commas. It can have any number of items inside, and they may even be of different data types, integer, float, string, boolean, or even another nested list, which contains other items of different data types, and so forth. Let's have a closer look at its syntax, so you can declare your own list. Here is an example, in which you want to store a list of strings. First, let's declare an empty list, with empty brackets. Eventually, you will add all of the strings, so that you can store and then access its values, later on. And that's it, congrats, you have just created your first list, in Python. A list containing zero items is called an empty list, and you can create one with empty brackets. But, you can also use the list constructor to declare a new list in Python, or even convert other data types, like string or tuples, into a list. That's great, but once you have created your list, you may also want to add other items, or update some values. Adding or updating lists items is very easy. Lists are mutable, which means their elements can be changed. In fact, you can add one item into a list, using the method append, or add several items at once, using the method extend. To add new values to a list, use the method append. But keep in mind that this method adds items only to the end of the list. For instance, if you want to add a new item, yellow, to this list, you will use the method append on your list, with the new item as parameter. Then, your list will grow and it will add this item at the end of the array, with a new index. Furthermore, you can insert one item at a desired location, by using the method insert. If you want to insert an item at a specific position in a list, you will use the insert method. Note that, all of the values in the list after the inserted value will be moved down one index. Consequently, adding the item yellow at the index 1 will result in moving green and blue respectively to the next indexes, and yellow taking place at index 1, right after the item red, which is at the index 0. Updating an entry to an existing list is simply a matter of assigning a new value, with the assignment operator equals. Thus, you can replace an existing element with its new value, by assigning the new value to the desired index. Note that, list indexing in Python is zero-based, as it is with strings. Thus, if you want to update the first item, at the index 0, you will assign a new value using the equals operator, and specify the index 0, between square brackets. This way, you can update the value red with yellow, then the last item blue, at index minus 1, by orange. Accessing an item. Of course, list's elements must be accessible, somehow. If you do not get them by key, like you would with dictionary in Python, then how would you get them? You can think of a list as a relationship between indexes and values. This relationship is called a mapping, where each index maps to only one of the values. Thus, individual items in a list can be accessed, using an index, in square brackets. This is exactly analogous to accessing individual characters, in a string. The index must be an integer, or it would result in type error. And, list indexing in Python is zero-based, as it is with strings. So, the first element of a list, will always be at the index 0. The indexes for the values in a list are illustrated as follow. For instance, a list having 5 elements will have an index vary from 0 through 4. And you can access individual items in a list, using its index, in square brackets. Consequently, if you want to get the first item, red, you will provide the index 0. The item, green, will be accessed using the index 1, the item, blue, with the index 2, and so on. Nonetheless, if you refer to an index that is not in this list, you will get an exception. To avoid such exception, Python will raise an error, index error, list index out of range, if you use an index that exceeds the number of items in your list. For instance, if you iterate through my list, and you did not specify how many items there are, you may result in accessing the item at the index 5, which does not exist and will raise this index error exception. Negative list indexing. Virtually everything about string indexing works similarly for lists. Thus, you can access a list by negative indexing, as well. For instance, a negative list index counts from the end of the list. So, the index of minus 1, refers to the last item. Minus 2, to the second last item, and so on. The negative indexes for the items in a list are illustrated as below, in this example. Slicing a list. A segment of a list, is called a slice. You can access, or extract, a range of items in a list, by using the slicing operator, colon. The slice operator my list, start, stop, returns the part of the list from the, start, item to the, stop, item, which will include the first item but exclude the last one. Please, note that a slice of a list, is also a list. And you may also want to optionally specify a step size parameter. But, if you do not specify the start parameter, it will start from the beginning of this list. On the other hand, if you did not specify the end parameter, it will take all the items until it reaches the end of the list. For example, if you want to access items between the index 2, included, and 7, excluded, it will give you the items C, D, E, F and G. There are several ways to remove items from a list. Either by its index, by its value, the last item in your list, or even remove all of them, at once. Remove an item by index. If you know the index of the item you want, you can use the pop method to remove an item, at a given index. It will modify the list and returns the removed item. Please note that if there is no index specified, pop removes and returns the last item in the list. This may help you implement lists as stacks, meaning the first in is the last out data structure. For instance, popping the item at the index 1 will remove its value, green, from my list, but it will keep its value in a variable so you can access it later and reuse it. If you do not need the removed value, you can delete one or more items from a list using this specific keyword del. In this same example, using the del keyword will definitely remove the item green from my list, but you won't be able to access this value anymore. The same way, if you want to remove more than one items, use the del keyword with a slice index. In this example, all the items in my list, from the indexes 1 through 3, included, will be removed. Remove an item by value. On the other hand, if you are not sure where the item is in the list, you can use the remove method to delete the given item by value. This way, you can deleted the item red, even though you do not have any idea where it is located inside my list. But keep in mind that if more than one instance of the given item is present, this method removes only the first instance and the other ones remain intact. Remove all items. Eventually, you can also use the clear method to remove all of the items from my list at once. And the del keyword to delete the list itself entirely. Checking items existence. To determine whether a value is or is not in a list, you can use in and not in operators combined with if statement. For instance, if you want to test whether the item red is in your list, just type if red in my list. And this will return the Boolean value true if the statement is valid, or false when the item yellow is not in your list. If you need help using this kind of logical statements, please check out the suggested videos on operators and conditionals in Python. You can also find more detailed examples on our website digital.academy.free.fr. Iterating through a list. Lists are a very useful and a widely used data structure in Python. As a developer, you will often be in situations where you will need to iterate through a list while you perform some actions on its items. Consequently, the most common way to iterate through a list is with a for loop. For instance, if you want to iterate over all the items of my list, which contains the values red, green, and blue, you will write for item in my list. So, on each iteration, the variable item will contain the value present at the current index. This works pretty well if you only need to read the items of the list. But, if you want to update them, you will need the indexes. A common way to do that is to combine the range and len functions altogether. For instance, this loop iterates through the list and double each item. If you do not know how the range function works, please check out the suggested video about Python for loops. Eventually, you may want to find how many items a list has. In that case, you do not have to iterate through the entire list and count each item. But simply use the function len, which directly returns the number of items in a list. Awesome, it is your time to practice now. In this example, you will have two variables, my item and my list. My item is the value you will be looking for inside my list. What you need is to check if a value is inside my list. If it is, iterate through this list using for loops. And find the index at which your item is. As soon as you found this item, break out of the loop and print a success message with its position in the list. Or print an error message, item not found. Here is a solution, and it may vary from yours. First, let's declare the two variables, my item and my list. Then, you will check whether my item is in my list, so that you do not have to iterate through the entire list unnecessarily. If the Boolean condition is true, you will use the range function combined with the len function. This way, you can have the value of the current index on each iteration, which is required if you want to update a specific item. Next, let's check whether the current item matches the item you were looking for, using the index I in square brackets. As soon as it does, you will print a success message containing the item and its position in my list. Then, in this example, break out of the loop so you do not spend more time with the next items. Obviously, you could also assume that my item is present multiple times in my list. Consequently, it would print out a new message each time this item has been found, and at a different position. Congrats! You just wrote your first lines of code, using list, for loop, if statements and logical operators, all of them combined, together. Please, do not forget to watch these suggested videos about Python for loops, and Python conditionals with logical operators, if you need help understanding one of these core concepts. And check out our blog, if you want more examples. Let's move forward to the next section. You may sometimes want or need to merge two lists, so that you can have all of your data, located in the same variable. Or, even update its values, with new content. In that cases, use the built-in extend method, to merge the values of one list, into another one. It takes a list as an argument, and appends all of the elements of this list, into the first list. Notice that, this method do not override existing values, but add them at the end of your list. As you can see in this example, merging the two lists will result in combining all of the items, red, green, and blue, with the new items, 1, 2, and 3. Alternatively, you can use the concatenation operator, plus, or the augmented assignment operator, plus equals, to combine two lists. This will produce the exact same result, with the first list containing all of the items. If you need help using operators, check out our blog and the video about Python operators. A list can contain sublists, as an item. Which, in turn, can contain sublists themselves, and so on. This is known as nested list. You can use them to store and arrange data, into hierarchical structures. Since the items of a list can be of any data type, my list can contain, strings, integers or even another nested list, with new items. Similarly, you can access individual items in a nested list, using multiple indexes. The first index, determines which list to use. And the second index, indicates the value within that list. Of course, a nested list can contain another list. Consequently, it would require a third index, to access items of this second list, and so forth. Indexes for the items in a nested list, are illustrated as below. Keep in mind that, all of the operations you have discovered earlier, can be performed on nested lists, as well. But, the deeper you are going to get an item, the more complex it will become, because of its syntax. So, it is sometimes more efficient to use another and more adapted data type, like dictionary in Python. Methods and functions. Python has a set of other built-in methods, that you can call on list objects. Some of them have been used throughout this video, so you can add, or insert new values. Even get or remove a specific value. But, you may sometimes want to sort a list. Duplicate a list. Count how many times an item is present inside your list. Gets its min or max values. Or even reverse it? Of course, all of that is possible in a very simple way, using these built-in methods. If you are interested to learn more about these methods, you can find more information on the Python website, and its documentation. In this tutorial, you have learned in-depth use about lists, in Python. This kind of data types is used, when you want to store a few items of any data type, in a very specific order. Consequently, you should now be able to, create a list, add, update or remove items, and even search for a specific item. Thus, lists should not be a secret anymore, and you can start using them in your program, straight away. In the next tutorial, you will discover another data type, in details, tuples. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In this brand new video, you will now discover dictionary in Python, so you can, create it, add and remove an item, iterate through a dictionary, searching for, and accessing a specific item inside of the collection, plus various built-in methods. Please, do not forget to smash that like button, for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us, and providing new free content, once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Definition. Dictionary in Python is a collection of items, which is unordered, indexed by keys and mutable, so it can be changed, once it has been created. While other data types have value as an element, a dictionary has a key-value pair, where each key is mapped to a single value. Consequently, dictionaries are optimized to get values, when the key is known. The important properties of Python dictionaries are as follows. Dictionaries are unordered. Items stored in a dictionary are not kept in any particular order. Dictionaries are mutable. They can be changed in place, can grow, and shrink on demand. Accessed by keys. Dictionary items are accessed by keys, not by their position. Dictionaries can be nested. A dictionary can contain another dictionary, and so forth. Great. Now that you have understood what a dictionary is, let's move forward and discover how to create a dictionary in Python, but also what are all of the operations you can perform on it, in order to add, remove, or access an item, or even search for a specific item inside of the dictionary. Creating a dictionary in Python is as simple as placing key value items inside curly braces, separated by comma. And each key is separated from its associated value, by a colon. While values can be of any data type and can repeat, keys must be unique, and of immutable type, like string, number or tuple with immutable elements. Let's have a closer look at its syntax, so you can declare your own dictionary. Here is an example, in which you want to store an employee record. First, let's declare an empty dictionary, using curly braces. Eventually, you will add all of the personal information about the employee, so you can store its information and then access it, later. Consequently, you will get as result a dictionary with the age, city, job, name and email address of an employee. Dictionaries are pretty straightforward, but here are a few points you should be aware of, when using them. Keys must be unique. A key can appear in a dictionary only once. Even if you specify a key more than once during the creation of a dictionary, the last value for that key becomes the associated value. Notice that the first occurrence of the key name, Jeremy, has been replaced by the second one, Digital Academy. Key must be immutable type. You can use any object of immutable type as dictionary keys, such as numbers, strings, booleans, tuples. Otherwise, an exception is raised, when mutable object is used as a key. Value can be of any type. There are no restrictions on dictionary values. A dictionary value can be any type of object, and can even appear in a dictionary, multiple times. There are lots of other ways to create a dictionary. You can convert two value sequences into a dictionary, using the built-in function dict. The first item inside each sequence is then used as the key, and the second, as the value. You can also use the dict function along with the zip function, to combine separate lists of keys and values, obtained dynamically, at runtime. Eventually, you may also want to create a dictionary with default values for each key. If you are interested in any of these cases, or want more detailed examples, please go on our website, digital.academy.free.fr, and check out this post. Adding or updating dictionaries items is very easy. Dictionaries are mutable, which means you can add new items or change the value of an existing item using assignment operator. If the key is already present, the value gets updated, else, a new key-value pair is added into the dictionary. Adding an entry to an existing dictionary is simply a matter of assigning a new key and value pair. If the key is new, it is added to the dictionary with its value. Here is an example, in which a new item is added into the dictionary, with the key, city, and its associated value, Paris. If the key is already present in the dictionary, its value will be replaced by the new one. Thus, if you want to update an entry, you can just assign a new value to an existing key. Here is an example, in which you will update the value of the key, name, which has a value, Digital Academy, and replace its value with, Jeremy. Of course, dictionary elements must be accessible, somehow. If you do not get them by index, then how would you get them? While indexing is used with other container types to access values, dictionary use keys. Values can be retrieved from a dictionary by specifying its corresponding key, in square brackets. Here is an example that prints the value of the key, name. Nonetheless, if you refer to a key that is not in the dictionary, you will get an exception. To avoid such exception, you can use the special dictionary get method. The difference while using get is that it returns none, instead of key error, if the key is not found. And returns the value associated to its key, if key is in the dictionary. There are several ways to remove items from a dictionary. Either by its key, the last inserted item, a random item, or even remove all of them, at once. If you know the key of the item you want, you can remove a particular item in a dictionary by using the function pop. This function removes an item with the provided key and returns its value. For instance, this example removes the key age and returns its value. If you do not need to keep nor use the removed value, you can also use the del keyword to remove individual items. To delete an entry, use the del statement, specifying the key to delete. Here is the same example, when you want to remove the key age but do not return its value. Sometimes you need to iterate through a dictionary in Python and delete its items sequentially. To accomplish this task, you can use the function pop item, which will remove and return the last inserted item from the dictionary. Please note that in Python versions before 3.7, the pop item method removes a random item, not necessarily the last inserted. All the items can be removed at once, using the clear method. Consequently, it will delete all keys and values from the dictionary. You can also use the del keyword to remove the entire dictionary itself. There are three dictionary methods that return all of the dictionary's keys, values and key-value pairs. These methods are useful in loops that need to step through dictionary entries, one by one, because all the three methods return iterable object. Keys. This method return an iterable object containing the list of all the keys present inside the dictionary. Values. On the other hand, this method return only a list of all the values inside the dictionary. Eventually, you may need to get both of them, at the same time. Fortunately, the items function provide this ability, and will return a list of tuples, in which, each one of the item, is composed of the key, and its associated value. If you want to know if a key exists in a dictionary, use the in and not in operators with the if statement. You can also use keys method to check whether your key is part of the dictionary's keys. On the other hand, to check whether a certain value exists in a dictionary, you must use in operator combined with the values method. Here are a few examples before you start practicing on your own. First, let's assume you have a dictionary, mydict, with the following properties, age, job and name. Next, you want to check whether the key name is part of this dictionary. Then, you will type name in mydict, which will return the Boolean value true, since name is present inside the dictionary's keys. Another way to do the exact same thing is to explicitly mention in which part of the dictionary you want to search, using the keys function. Let's try with another one, and test whether salary is present. Did you guess it? That's right, salary is not inside dictionary's keys, consequently, it will only result in the Boolean value false. And this is exactly the same when you want to check if a value is inside the dictionary, except that you will use the values function. For instance, checking whether Digital Academy is a value of my dictionary will return true, but Jeremy will not. You got it. To check whether a key, or a value, is part of my dictionary, just use the in operator, combined with the associated function, keys or values. Dictionaries are a very useful and widely used data structure, in Python. As a developer, you will often be in situations where you will need to iterate through a dictionary, while you perform some actions on its key-value pairs. When you are working with dictionaries, it is likely that you will want to work with both the keys and the values. One of the most useful ways to iterate through a dictionary in Python is by using items, which is a method that returns a new view of the dictionary's items and will contain all of the key-value pairs as tuples key-value inside of a list. On each iteration, the current tuple will be unpacked in the form of key-value, so you can either access the key or the value individually. If you just need to work with the keys of a dictionary, then you can use keys function, which is a method that returns a new view object containing the dictionary's keys. On each iteration, the current item will only be the key, not its associated value. If you use a dictionary in a for loop, it traverses the keys of the dictionary by default. But it is also common to only use the values to iterate through a dictionary in Python. One way to do that is to use values, which returns a view with the values of the dictionary. On each iteration, the current item will only be the value, not its associated key. Eventually, you may want to find how many key-value pairs a dictionary has. In that case, you do not have to iterate through a dictionary and count each item, but use the function len, which returns the number of items in a dictionary. Awesome, it's your time to practice now. Let's assume you will have a dictionary containing the exact same key-value pairs that we have used in all of the previous examples. First, declare this dictionary, my dict, and add a few items inside of it, age equals 27, job equals YouTuber, my key equals like, comment, subscribe, and name equals Digital Academy. Then, you want to check whether a specific key, my key, is inside this dictionary. And, only if it is, iterate throughout the dictionary. Print the value of this key when found, then stop the entire loop as soon as you encountered it. Otherwise, if you did not find this key, print an error message. Here is a solution, and may vary from yours. First, check whether my key is in the dictionary's keys, so you don't have to iterate through the dictionary if not necessarily, and save some time to your program. Then, if this expression returns true in the if statements, iterate through the dictionary using for loop. Combined with the items function, you will get a tuple key value for each iteration. Unpack it into two variables, k and v, so that you can later access them individually. Now, you want to check whether the current key k is the key you were looking for, if k equals my key. If so, you will enter the if statement and print a success message with the value associated to this key. Plus, you will break as soon as you encountered your key. Since a key is unique in a dictionary, it won't continue with the next items and saves some time during its execution. On the other hand, if my underscore key was not found inside of your dictionary, it will not even execute the for loop, but will enter the else clause and print an error message. And that's it, congrats! You have just written your first dictionary, iterated through this dictionary using for loop, and found a specific key's value. Notice that all of this code was not necessarily, since if my key was part of the dictionary's key, you could have get access to its value without even iterating through it. But that was a little exercise, so you can practice using for loops, if statements and dictionary, all of them combined, together. Please, do not forget to watch the videos about for loops, and the conditional if statements, if you need help understanding one of the core concepts, in Python. You may sometimes want or need to merge two dictionaries, so that you can have all of your data located in the same variable. Or update its values, with new content. Use the built-in update method to merge the keys and values of one dictionary into another. Notice that this method blindly overwrites values of the same key. If there is already an existing key inside of the first dictionary, its value will be updated with the new one. And new keys will be created if there were not already existing. As you can see in this example, merging the two dictionaries will result in combining all of the items and updating the ones that existed before. Finally, Python has a set of built-in methods and functions that you can invoke on dictionary objects. Here are some of the most important and used functions. Some of them have been covered throughout this Python tutorial for beginners. But do not hesitate to pause this video and have a look at the Python documentation if you need more information about what they can be used for and how to use them. In this tutorial, you have learned in-depth use about dictionary in Python. This kind of data types is used when you want to store a pair of key value and access a value in a very efficient way, thanks to its key. Consequently, you should now be able to create a dictionary, add, update or remove a few items, and even search for a specific item. Dictionary should no be a secret anymore, and you can start using them in your program straight away. In the next tutorial, you will discover another data type in details, list. List is an ordered collection which is often used when you want to store item in a particular order. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In this brand new video, you will now discover another data type, tuples. Be sure to stick around, and watch until the end of this video, if you want to discover various actions and methods that you can perform on tuples, and practice with an exercise. Please, do not forget to smash that like button, for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us, and providing new free content, once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Definition. Python provides another kind of data type, called a tuple. Tuples are a lot like lists in Python, and are used to collect objects in order. Consequently, everything you have learned about lists is true, for tuples as well. A tuple in Python is an ordered collection of values, which is accessed by index, and contains any sort of objects, like numbers, strings, lists, or even other nested tuples. Lists and tuples can contain duplicate members. Except that tuples are immutable, which means you theoretically cannot add, delete, or change items inside the tuple, once created. Nonetheless, you can iterate through a tuple, with a simple for loop as well. Why use a tuple then, instead of a list? Program execution is faster when manipulating a tuple, than it is for the equivalent list. Sometimes you do not want data to be modified. If the values in the collection are meant to remain constant for the life of the program, using a tuple instead of a list protects your data from accidental modification. There is another Python data type called a dictionary, which requires as keys, a value that is of an immutable type. A tuple can be used for this purpose, whereas a list cannot be. Awesome. You know what a tuple can be used for. But, how to declare a tuple, pack and unpack some values, or even access specific items? Let's find out, throughout these next sections. Creating a tuple. Unlike lists in Python, tuples are defined by enclosing the elements in parentheses instead of square brackets. You can create a tuple by placing a comma-separated sequence of items, in parentheses. Thus, a tuple containing zero items is called an empty tuple, and you can create one with empty parentheses. The items of a tuple do not have to be the same type. For instance, the following tuple contain integers, strings, float, or Boolean values. Syntactically, a tuple is just a comma-separated list of values. You do not necessarily need the parentheses to create a tuple. It is the trailing commas that really define a tuple. But, using parentheses does not hurt, because they help make the tuple more visible. Since parentheses are also used to define operator precedence in expressions, Python evaluates the expression 7 as simply the integer 7, and creates an integer object. To tell Python that you really want to define a singleton tuple, with only one value, include a trailing comma, just before the closing parenthesis. It is also possible to use the tuple constructor, when you want to create a tuple. And, you can convert other data types to tuple, using Python's tuple constructor, as well. For instance, wrapping a list or a string into the constructor tuple, will convert it into a tuple. And you will have access to all the methods and benefits of using tuples, in Python. Packing and unpacking. When a tuple is created, the items in the tuple are packed together, into an object. In this example, the values red, green, blue, and yellow are packed together into my tuple. But, when a packed tuple is then unpacked, the individual items are unpacked and assigned into the items you defined. In this example, the tuple my tuple is unpacked into the variables red, green, blue, and yellow so that you can access each one of them individually. When unpacking, the number of variables on the left must match the number of items in the tuple. Here are some very common errors, during tuple unpacking. Too many arguments, or not enough values to unpack. In fact, this happens when you will try to unpack a tuple that has more, or less, values on the tuple itself, than the number of variables on the left side. This results in not enough values to unpack, and expect more items, or less variables. Eventually, you may also want to unpack only some values, from your tuple. But, do not store all of its items inside each variable. Fortunately, Python provides this feature, using underscore. This way, each item is mapped into a new variable, when it has one affected. And store its value, so you can access it later. When a variable is replaced by an underscore, its associated value inside the tuple will not be extracted. This is very useful, when you do not need certain items, and want to optimize your memory. Awesome. But, you do not have any idea when using packing and unpacking methods might be useful for you? You can find more examples in which you may want to pack and unpack a tuple on our blog, at digital.academy.free.fr. Accessing an item. You can access individual items in a tuple using an index in square brackets, or using the unpacking method. Note that tuple indexing in Python starts from zero, and is similar to lists. The indices for the elements in a tuple are illustrated as below. If you want to access or extract the first value red of my tuple, which is located at the index 0, you will specify the index 0 in square brackets. The index 1 for green, 2 for blue, and so forth. You can access a tuple by negative indexing as well. Negative indexing counts backward, from the end of the tuple. So, my tuple with the index minus 1 refers to the last item, black, my tuple with the index minus 2 is the second last item, yellow, and so on. But be careful not to access an element outside of your tuple, or you would get an index error, tuple index out of range exception. Okay, but how you would access a range of items, from your tuple? You will need to slice a tuple, using the slicing operator. Tuple slicing is similar to list slicing, in which you will specify the start and end indexes with an optional step size. Each parameter can be positive or negative indexing values. Do you want to discover more about Python slicing operators? Please, check out our blog, and the video about lists in Python. Adding and updating tuple. As you know, tuples are immutable. Once a tuple has been created, it cannot be modified afterwards, or it would trigger an error, type error exception. Tuple object does not support item assignment. That's what it costs if you want to increase security and its speed when manipulating tuples. Consequently, when you use this kind of data type, you are not supposed to add, update, or remove items from a tuple. But, there is a workaround, you can convert the tuple into a list which is of mutable type, change the items in the list, then convert the list back into a tuple. Note that the tuple immutability is applicable only to the top level of the tuple itself, not to its contents. For example, a list inside a tuple can be changed as usual with indexing, without even converting the tuple into a list first. Removing an item. Tuples cannot be modified, because they are immutable. So, obviously, you cannot directly delete any item, either. But, the same way you did with updating an item, you can convert the tuple into a list, delete an item, then convert the list back into a tuple. And if you do not need your tuple anymore, you can completely delete the tuple itself, using the del keyword. Checking the existence of an item. To determine whether a value is or is not in a tuple, you can use in and not in membership operators, combined with Python if statement. For instance, the expression if red in my tuple will give a Boolean value true, because the item is part of my tuple. But the expression if yellow in my tuple will result in false, and will not enter the if statement. If you need help using these kind of statements, please check out the suggested videos on Python operators and conditionals, if, else, and else if statements in Python. Iterating through a tuple. Tuple is a very useful and a widely used data structure. As a Python developer, you will often be in situations where you will need to iterate through a tuple while you perform some actions on its items. Fortunately, the most common way to iterate through a tuple is with a for loop. For instance, for item in my tuple, print item will iterate throughout all the items of my tuple and print out each item, red, green, and blue. This works well if you only need to read the items of a tuple. But, if you want to update them, you need the indexes. A common way to do that is to use the enumerate function. For instance, this loop iterates through the tuple, unpack the index and value of the current item on each iteration, and print out each item with its associated index. If you do not know how to use the range function nor how the enumerate function works, please check out the suggested video about Python for loops. Eventually, you may also want to find how many items a tuple has. In that case, you do not have to iterate through the entire tuple and count each item, but simply use the function len, which returns the number of items inside your tuple. Merging and sorting a tuple. Although tuples are not changeable, you may sometimes want or need to merge two tuples, so that you can have all of your data located in the same variable. Or, even update its items with new values. Fortunately, two tuples can be joined to combine all of the items, using the concatenation operator, plus, or the augmented assignment operator, plus equals. For instance, adding the values 1, 2 and 3 to my tuple, will result in a tuple containing all of the items combined. Notice that tuples keep duplicate members, so this method does not override existing values, but add them at the end of the tuple. If you need help using operators, check out our blog and the video about Python operators. Awesome. But how would you proceed if you need to rearrange items inside of your tuple? There are two methods to sort a tuple, using a built-in method, or convert it into a mutable object first, then rearrange it. Method 1, use the built-in sorted method, that accepts any sequence object as parameter. Method 2, convert a tuple to a mutable object first, like list. Gain access to a sorting method call. And convert it back to a tuple. Either way, you will get the same sorted tuple, blue, green, red and yellow. Awesome, it's your time to practice now. All of these instructions are in the description below, and will combine all the methods you have discovered during this class. In this exercise, you will have to declare a tuple with the values red, green, blue, yellow, and black. First, you will have to unpack this tuple into multiple variables, within their respective names. Then, if the tuple has a value green and that it corresponds to the second item, update the variable yellow with the value orange, then change the order of the items, by swapping the values of the variables red and black together. Finally, you will pack all these variables into a new tuple, and iterate through the items until you meet the value orange. Once you have encountered this item, convert this tuple into a list, use its index to update the value orange back to its original value yellow, and convert it back to your tuple. Then, break out of the loop once it's done. Eventually, you will use the slicing operator so that you do not keep the last value, and print out the resulting tuple. Please, do tell me in the comment, what did you get? Here is a solution, and may vary from yours. First let's declare a variable myTuple, with the values red, green, blue, yellow, and black. Then, unpack this tuple into variables with their respective names. Now, you will check whether an item green exists inside myTuple, and if it corresponds to the second item. If it does, you will enter the if statement and change the value of the variable yellow, with the value orange. Plus, swap the two variables red and black together, so that the variable red becomes black, and the variable black becomes red. Before proceeding with the for loop, you will pack all the variables into a new tuple. Then iterate through its items using for loop and the enumerate function, so that you can access both the current value, and its associated index in the tuple. As soon as you encounter the value orange, you will convert your tuple into a list. Update the item located at this index, with the new value, yellow. Then, convert it back into your tuple, so you can exit the loop straight away. Finally, you will use the slicing operator so you keep all of the items inside your tuple, except the last one. Running this program should give you the tuple, black, green, blue, and yellow, since the last one has been removed. Congrats! You just wrote your first complex program using tuple, and some of the operations you can perform on it. Please tell me in the comments, if you found the answer, or have any question? And check out our blog, if you want more examples. Methods and functions. Python has a set of other built-in methods that you can call on tuple objects. Some have been discovered throughout this video, so you can add or update values, even get or remove a specific item. But, you may also want to merge or sort a tuple, count how many times an item is present inside your tuple, gets its min or max values, and even get the index of a specific item. Of course, all of that is possible in a very simple way, using these built-in methods. If you are interested to learn more about these methods, you can find more information on the Python documentation website. In this tutorial, you have learned in-depth use about tuples, in Python. This kind of data types is used, when you want to store a few items of any data type in a very specific order, access its values faster than with a list, plus add some extra security to prevent accidental modification of its values. Consequently, you should now be able to create a tuple, pack and unpack a few values, or even search for a specific item. Thus, tuples should not be a secret anymore, and you can start using them in your Python program, straight away. In the next tutorial, you will discover another data type, in details, sets. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In this brand new video, you will now discover another data type, sets. Be sure to stick around and watch until the end of this video if you want to discover various actions and methods that you can perform on sets in Python. Please do not forget to smash that like button for the YouTube algorithm, since it does really help supporting us and providing new free content once a week. Are you interested to be part of this community? All the links are in the description below. Now, let's play this video. Definition: Python offers a range of compound data types, often referred to as sequences. Set is one of the most frequently used data types in Python, amongst list, dictionary, and tuple. In fact, set in Python is a collection of items, and its important properties are as follows. Unordered: items stored in a set are not kept in any particular order. Not indexed: you cannot access set items by referring to an index. Contains only unique elements: set items are unique, and duplicate items are not allowed. Is of mutable type: sets can be changed, grow, and shrink once it has been created, on demand. Moreover, sets in Python are commonly used for computing mathematical operations such as union, intersection, difference, and symmetric difference operations. Great. Now that you have understood what a set is, let's move forward and discover how to create a set in Python. But also, what are all of the operations that you can perform on it in order to add, remove, or access an item, even search for a specific item inside of this set? So be sure to stick around and watch this entire video. Creating a set. There are several ways to create a new set. In Python programming language, the simplest way to create a set is to enclose all of the items, also known as elements, inside curly braces and separated by commas. It can have any number of items inside, and they can even be of different data types: integer, float, string, boolean, or even another object, which contains other items of different data types, and so forth. Although a set itself is mutable, it cannot contain mutable objects. Therefore, only immutable objects like numbers, strings, and tuples can be a set item. But lists and dictionaries are mutable, so they cannot be a set item. Now, let's have a closer look at its syntax, so you can declare your own set and start practicing. Here is an example, in which you want to store a list of strings. First, let's declare an empty set, with empty curly braces. Eventually, you will add all of the strings, so that you can store and then access these values, later on. My set equals red, green, and blue, surrounded by curly braces. But, remember, sets do not allow duplicate members, they are automatically removed, during its creation. Consequently, my set, which has been declared with the values red, green, blue, and red again, will only contain these items once: green, blue, and red. As you have seen, a set containing zero items is called an empty set, and you can create one with empty curly braces. But you can also create a new set in Python using its type constructor, called set. Or even convert other data types into a set, like string, tuples, or any object of immutable type. This way, you can convert the string ABC into a new set, containing the items A, B, and C, but also convert a list or a tuple, which contains the items 1, 2, and 3, into another set. One thing to keep in mind is that this conversion would remove any duplicate members automatically. That's great, but once you have created your set, you may also want to add other items, or even update some values inside, right? Then, let's see how it all works in the next section. Adding and updating items to a set. Adding or updating sets items is very easy. Sets are mutable, which means their elements can be changed. In fact, you can add one single item into a set using the method add. This method adds an item, but not at the very end of the set, since sets are not indexed, remember. Consequently, you can create a set with the items red, green, and blue. Then add the item yellow to this set using the method add and your item as parameter. You can also add multiple items at once using the method update. This way, all items inside your iterable object, whether it is a list or a tuple, will be added into your set, if the item does not already exist inside, of course. Consequently, the items yellow and orange will be added to my set, but not necessarily kept in this specific order. Nonetheless, since a set is not indexed, you cannot update any value once it has been added inside. Consequently, your only way to update an item in a set would be to remove this value, and only then add another one. If you want to know how to remove an item from a set in Python, please follow along this video and its next sections. Accessing an item. Of course, sets elements must be accessible somehow. Unfortunately, sets are not indexed and unordered. If you do not get its values by keys nor indexes, like you would with a dictionary or list in Python, then how would you get them? Well, the only way to access an item of a set in Python is to iterate through every single item, using for and while loops. Eventually, you may also want to get a random item, using the method pop. Let's move forward to the next sections and discover how it works. Removing items from a set. There are several ways to remove items from a set, either by its value or a random item within your set, and even remove all of them at once. Removing an item by index. If you do not know the value of the item you want, you can use the pop method to remove an item located at a random position. It will modify the set and returns the removed item. For instance, let's first declare a set with the colors red, green, and blue. Then, call the function pop to remove a random value and store its value inside my item. As you see, the method pop will modify my set and returns the removed item, blue. Nonetheless, you did not choose which value to remove from my set. Fortunately for you, Python provides this ability. Removing an item by value. If you are not sure where the item is in the set, and that you want to remove a specific and single value but do not need to store it, you can use the methods remove or discard to delete this item by its value. But keep in mind that if more than one instance of the given item is present, this method removes only the first instance found. Both methods work exactly the same way. The only difference is that, if the specified item is not present in a set, the method remove raises a key error exception, whereas the method discard does nothing but remove this value if found. Removing all items. Eventually, you may also want to remove all items from a set at once. You can use the method clear to permanently and fully remove all items from the set at once. Then the specific keyword del to delete the set itself entirely. And you're done, there is nothing left. Checking the existence of an item. To determine whether a value is or is not in a set, you can use in and not in operators in Python combined with the conditional if statement. For instance, let's check whether red is part of my set, using the expression, if red in my set. This will return a Boolean value that evaluates only if the given condition is true, then enter the conditional body statements. If you need help using these kind of statements, please check out the suggested videos on operators and conditionals in Python. Iterating through a set. Sets are a very useful and a widely used data structure in Python. As a developer, you will often be in situations where you will need to iterate through a set while you perform some actions with its items. Therefore, the most common way to iterate through a set is using for loop iterations. This works well if you only need to read the items of the set. But, if you want to know at which position an item is, you will need its indexes. A common way to do that is to convert your set into a list, then combine the functions range and len altogether, or use the enumerate function. If you do not know how the enumerate function works, please check out a suggested video about Python for loops. Eventually, you may want to find how many items a set has. In that case, you do not have to iterate through the entire set and count each item, but use the function len, which returns the number of items in a set. Awesome! You know how to create a set, add values and iterate through its items. But you might be still wondering, what are sets used for? Let's find out and go through the last section of this class, joining two sets. Sets are commonly used for computing mathematical operations, such as intersection, union, difference, and symmetric difference. Consequently, there are several ways to join two or more sets in Python. Set union. Union of the sets A and B is the set of all items in either A or B. Therefore, you can use the method union or the operator pipe that returns a new set containing all the items from two or more sets. Or the method update that inserts all the items from one set into another set. For instance, let's declare a first set, A, with the items red, green and blue. Then the second set, B, with the items yellow, red and orange. Either if you are more comfortable using the method union or the operator pipe, both resulting sets will contain all items from both sets combined. But there are other methods that joins two sets and keeps only the duplicates or, on the opposite, never keeps the duplicate items. Set intersection. Intersection of the sets A and B is the set of items common to both A and B. You can perform intersection on two or more sets using the method intersection or an operator. Consequently, the intersection of both sets will result in a new set, containing only the item red, which is the unique item common to both A and B. Set difference. Set difference of A and B is the set of all items that are in A, but not in B. You can compute the difference between two or more sets using the method difference or minus operator. Consequently, the difference of both sets will result in a new set, containing the items blue and green, because these items are present in the first set A, but not in the second set, B. Set symmetric difference. Symmetric difference of sets A and B is the set of all elements, in either A or B, but not both. You can compute symmetric difference between two or more sets using the method symmetric underscore difference or XOR operator. Consequently, the symmetric difference of these two sets will give you a new set with all elements from both set that are not in the other set. This will result with items orange, blue, green and yellow, since red is part of both sets. Built-in functions, with set. Python has a set of other built-in functions and methods, that you can call on sets objects. Some of them have been used throughout this video, so you can add or insert new values, even get or remove a specific value. But, you may sometimes want to sort a set, count how many times an item is present inside your set, gets its min or max values, or even determine whether a set is a subset of another set. Of course, all of that is possible in a very simple way, using these built-in methods. If you are interested to learn more about these methods, you can find more information on the Python website and its documentation. Please, also check out our blog if you want more examples on digital.academy.free.fr. In this tutorial, you have learned in-depth use about sets, in Python. This kind of data types is used when you want to compute mathematical operations, or do not store any duplicate members. Consequently, you should now be able to create a set, add or remove a few items, or even search for a specific item. Thus, sets should not be a secret anymore, and you can start using them in your Python program, straight away. In the next tutorial, you will finally discover functions, so that you can arrange and reuse your code, in Python. So, do not waste any minute of it, and join us in the next episode. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In this brand new video, you will now discover a new way to write your own program, using functions. So be sure to stick around and watch until the end of this video if you want to discover more. Definition: what is a function in Python? In Python, a function is a group of related statements that performs a specific task. Functions help break your program into pieces of smaller and modular chunks. As your program grows larger and larger, functions make it more organized and manageable. Furthermore, it avoids repetition, makes the code reusable, and allows you to work collaboratively. That's true. Functions are the first step to code reuse. They allow you to define a reusable block of code that can be used repeatedly in your program. Actually, Python provides several built-in functions, such as print, len, or type. But you can also define your own functions to use within your programs. Now, let's have a closer look at its syntax with an example. The basic syntax for a Python function definition is as follows. The keyword def, that marks the start of the function header. The function name, to uniquely identify the function throughout your program. Optional parameters, also called as arguments, through which you pass values to a function. 1: to mark the end of the function header. Optional documentation string, to describe what the function does. one or more valid Python statements in the function body, with the same indentation level, usually 4 spaces. Optional return statement, to return a value from the function. Creating a function. To define a Python function, use the keyword def, followed by your function name with parenthesis, and one colon. Here is the simplest possible function, that prints out, "Hello world." Pretty simple, right? Then, let's move forward to the next section, and discover how to call this function. Calling a function. The def statement only creates a function, but does not call it, afterwards. You must call or run the function explicitly, by adding parentheses after the function's name. Consequently, once you have defined your function, you can call it from another function, and anywhere in your program, or even from the Python interpreter. And it will print your message, "Hello world," as soon as the function is called. Awesome! You can now define your own block of code in Python, also known as function. You can call this function from anywhere in your program. But, what is the point, if this block of code cannot be customized, with user-defined values? Well, let's see how argument works, and how to pass these arguments to your function. Passing arguments. You can send information to a function, by passing values, known as arguments. Arguments are declared after the function's name, in parentheses. When you call a function with arguments, the values of those arguments are copied into their corresponding parameters, inside the function. Here is an example, in which you can pass the name as an argument, and will print a hello message using this value. Obviously, you can send as many arguments as you like, separated by commas. Here is a function that takes two values as positional arguments, and print a more complex but still simple message, "Jeremy is a YouTuber." Python handles function arguments in a very flexible manner, compared to other languages. It supports multiple types of arguments in the function definition. And here is the complete list. Let's have a look at each one of them. Positional arguments. The most common arguments are positional arguments, whose values are copied into their corresponding parameters, and in order. This type of argument is the one you have seen earlier. The only downside of positional arguments, is that you need to pass arguments in the order in which they are defined. Otherwise, statements inside your function's body might result in a complete different behavior, and errors may occur. Keyword arguments. To avoid positional argument confusion, you can pass arguments using the names of their corresponding parameters. In this case, the order of the arguments no longer matters, because arguments are matched by name, not by position. For instance, whether the keyword argument, name, comes before or after the keyword argument, job, does not matter, because names will match anyway. Therefore, its behavior will remain the same and variables are printed out in the correct order. Please note that, it is also possible to combine positional and keyword arguments, in a single call. If you do so, specify the positional arguments before keyword arguments. Default arguments. You can also specify default values for arguments, when defining a function. The default value is used if the function is called without a corresponding argument. In short, defaults allow you to make selected arguments optional. Let's have a look. In this function, name is a positional argument, and job is used as a keyword argument, with a default value to developer. So, if you intentionally call this function with another value for the argument job, it will override it and use the value you passed as argument instead, "Jeremy is a YouTuber." But, if no value is passed, the default value, developer, will be assigned to the variable job, inside the function, "Jeremy is a developer." Does that make sense? Okay, let's continue with variable length arguments. Variable length arguments are very useful when you want to create functions that take unlimited number of arguments. Unlimited, in the sense that you do not know beforehand how many arguments can be passed to a function by the user. These are subdivided in two types. Variable length positional arguments, args. When you prefix a parameter with an asterisk, it collects all the unmatched positional arguments into a tuple. Because it is a normal tuple object, you can perform any operation that a tuple supports, like indexing, iteration, etc. For instance, the following function prints all the arguments passed to the function, as a tuple. Please note that, You do not necessarily need to call this keyword parameter args, but it is standard practice. Variable length keyword arguments, quargs. The double asterisk syntax is similar, but it only works for keyword arguments. It collects them into a new dictionary, where the argument names are the keys, and their values are the corresponding dictionary values. For instance, any keyword arguments passed to this function will be stored into a dictionary, and only accessible using the quargs variable. Pretty awesome, right? You can now define your own function, and use all kind of arguments, positional and keyword arguments, with or without default values. And even variable length arguments, using args and quargs keywords. That's great, Jeremy. But, again, what's the point if I defined a function, but I cannot get back its result? Hopefully, Jeremy from Digital Academy is here to help you out. So, keep watching. Let's move forward, and discover the return statement. Returning values. The return statement in Python is used to exit a function and go back to the place from where it was called. This statement can contain an expression that gets evaluated, and the value is returned. If there is no expression in the statement, or the return statement itself is not present inside a function, then the function will return the none object. In this example, none is returned, since hello directly prints the name passed as argument, but no return statement is used. To return a value from a function, simply use a return statement. Once a return statement is executed, nothing else in the function body will be executed. Remember, Python function always returns a value. Therefore, if you do not include any return statement, it automatically returns none. In this example, the function sum will return the sum of two variables, and store its value into a variable outside the function, so it can be used later on. Python also has the ability to return multiple values, something missing from many other languages. Fortunately for you, you can simply do this by separating return values with a comma. For instance, this function will return both the addition and the subtraction of two variables. When you return multiple values, Python actually packs them into a single tuple and returns it. Consequently, you can then use multiple assignment to unpack the parts of the returned tuple into multiple variables. This way, you can extract the result from both the addition and the subtraction, then get access to each one of them individually. If you need more help with tuples, please watch the suggested video in the description below. Wow, functions in Python are very useful, and you should start using them in your program straight away. So, let's practice now, it's your turn. Suppose you want to sum up all the items of a list passed as argument to your function, which contains the values 1, 2, 4, 6, 8 and 10. Then, return the computed result. How would you proceed? Here is a solution. First, let's declare a list with the items 1, 2, 4, 6, 8 and 10. Then, define your function sum underscore list, and add the following statement inside your function. If you want to add all items from a list, you have to iterate using for loop, for item in my list. And add the current item to your local variable result, previously initialized. Result plus equals item. Eventually, when no elements are left and you reach the end of your list, your function will return the result. That's it, you just wrote your own function that iterates through a list, adds all items, and returns the sum of all of them. Please, tell me in the comment, what result did you get? Did you find another way to do the same thing? I will reply to everyone in the comments, and help each other from this community. If you need more help with Python for loops, conditional if statements, and even lists in Python, check out our blog, and the suggested videos. Awesome, let's move forward to the last sections of this tutorial, and discover how to correctly comment your functions in Python and, more generally, how to comment your code. Although optional, documentation is a good programming practice, especially if you want to get your dream job at Google, Apple, Facebook or anywhere in the world, and work collaboratively. Plus, unless you can remember what you had for dinner last week, always documenting your code will help you a lot when you will need to stay away for a while, then come back. Hopefully, You can attach documentation to a function definition by including a string literal, called docstring, just after the function header. It is briefly used to explain what a function does. Also note that docstrings are usually triple quoted, to allow for multi-line descriptions. To print a function's docstring, use the Python help function, and pass the function's name as argument. This will print out the docstring in rich format, and help you better understand what this function does. You can also access the docstring in a raw format, through the doc attribute of the function. Nested functions. A nested function is a function defined within another function. They are very useful when performing complex tasks multiple times, within another function, to avoid loops and code duplication, outside. In this example, the outer function simply defines an inner function that will return the sum of two variables. The outer function then returns the result of the inner function, which was adding both arguments. This might not be easy to understand at first glance, but nested functions allow you to avoid code duplication or to redefine a function with the same name, which will be used only from inside the outer function, and its scope. A recursive function is a function that calls itself and repeats its behavior until some condition is met to return a result. In this example, countdown is a recursive function that calls itself recursively to countdown. If number is 0 or negative, it prints the word stop, then automatically exits this function. Otherwise, it prints number and then calls itself again, passing number 1 as the new argument. In this complete tutorial, you have learned functions in Python. Consequently, you should now be able to define your own function, pass different kind of arguments to your function, and get its returned value. Thus, functions should not be a secret anymore, and you can start using them in your Python program straight away. In the next tutorial, you will finally discover exceptions in Python, so that you can finally catch errors in your program without even interrupting its execution flow. So, do not waste any minute, and join us in the next episode. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. In this brand new video, you will now discover how to define, raise, catch and handle exceptions in Python, with the help of a few examples. So be sure to stick around, and watch till the end, if you want to handle errors in your program, without even interrupting its execution flow. When executing Python code, different errors may occur: coding errors made by the programmer, errors due to wrong input, or even other unforeseeable errors. When your program encounters an error and that something in the program goes wrong, the Python interpreter stops the current process, and passes it to the calling process, until it is handled. This is the default exception handling behavior in Python. If not handled, the program will crash straight away, and prints an error message. But, if you do not want this default behavior, you need to handle these exceptions in your program. And that is where try and accept statements comes in. Python errors. You can make certain mistakes while writing a program that lead to errors, when you try to run it. During its execution, Python program terminates as soon as it encounters an error that is not handled. These errors can be classified into two classes: syntax errors, and logical errors, also known as exceptions. Errors caused by not following the proper structure of the language are called syntax error or parsing error. Syntax errors are the most basic type of error. They arise when the Python parser is unable to understand a line of code. Most syntax errors are typos, incorrect indentation, or incorrect arguments. If you get this error, try looking at your code for any of these: misspelling, missing, or misusing keyword. An arrow indicates where the parser ran into the syntax error. Errors that occur at runtime, after passing the syntax test, are called exceptions, or logical errors. These are the most difficult type of error to find, because they will give unpredictable results, and may even crash your program. A lot of different things can happen if it encounters a logical error. Whenever these types of runtime errors occur, Python will create an exception object. Exceptions arise when the Python parser knows what to do with this piece of code, but is unable to perform this action. For instance, trying to access the internet without an internet connection. Illegal operations can raise exceptions, too. Actually, there are plenty of built-in exceptions that are raised in Python when the following errors occur: value error, type error, zero division error, import error, and so many more. Consequently, if not handled properly, Python prints the traceback of that error. And the last line of this message indicates what type of exception error your program ran into, along with some details about what triggered this error. Fortunately, you can catch and handle all these kind of exceptions, then adapt your program so it does not crash anymore. You can also define your own exceptions in Python, when required. After seeing the differences between syntax errors and exceptions, let's move forward and see multiple ways to raise, catch, and handle these exceptions in Python. Assertion. Instead of waiting for a program to crash midway, you can also start by making an assertion in Python, and verify that a certain condition is met. If this condition turns out to be true, then that is excellent, your program continues. But, if the condition turns out to be false, your program will throw an assertion error exception. Let's have a look at the following example, where it is asserted that the code will be executed on a Linux system. If you run this code on a Linux machine, the assertion passes. If you were to run this code on a Windows machine, or any other machine, the outcome of the assertion would be false, raising an exception and printing out the following traceback, with this message, this code runs on Linux only. In this example, throwing an assertion error exception is the last thing that the program will do. The program will come to halt, and will not continue. But, what if that is not what you wanted? Then, you will have to catch this exception. In Python, all exceptions can be handled using the try except statements. The critical operations which can raise an exception, is placed inside the try clause. And the code that handles the exception, is written in the except clause. You can thus choose what operations to perform, once you have caught this exception. Now, let's have a closer look. Catch all exceptions. When an error occurs, Python would normally throw an exception, generate an error message and stop the program, if this exception is not handled properly. But, when this error occurs during its execution, and inside the try statement, the rest of the try block is skipped, as soon as this error is encountered, and the except block is executed. That's right, the very simple try and except block in Python is used to catch and handle all these exceptions. Python will execute the code following the try statement, until an exception is encountered. The code that follows the except statement determines how your program responds to any of these exceptions. Consequently, the except clause is used to catch and handle all the exceptions that are encountered in the try clause. What you did not get to see though, was the type of error that was thrown as a result of the exception. In order to see exactly what went wrong, you would need to catch the error that the code threw, with an alias, except exception as error. Awesome. But, what if you do not want to execute the same block of code, for every exceptions? Fortunately for you, Python provides the ability to catch a single and specific exception, or even multiple exceptions at once. Let's find out. Catch single exception. In the previous example, we did not mention any specific exception in the except clause. It is not a good programming practice, as it will catch all exceptions, regardless of your error, and handles every case in the same way. Nonetheless, you can specify which exceptions an except clause will catch. Value error, type error, zero division error, import error, etc. In above example, the try block will generate an exception, because a number is divided by zero. Therefore, the except block zero division error will be executed only for this specific error. Any other errors will not be handled in this case, and may end up crashing your program. That's great, but you are wondering, how to handle multiple exceptions in Python then? Here is the solution. Catch multiple exceptions. A try clause can have any number of except clauses, to handle different exceptions. However, only one will be executed, in case an exception occurs. Consequently, you can define as many except blocks as you want, so that you can catch and handle specific exceptions, individually, and differently. And, if you want to execute the same block of code, for multiple exceptions, specify all the exceptions inside a tuple. Please, also note that, Python does not just handle exceptions if they occur immediately in the try block, but also if they occur inside functions, that are called in the try block. That is so cool. Your program will never crash anymore, since you can catch and handle all exceptions raised during its execution. But, how would you execute a block of code, only when no exceptions were encountered, in the try clause? In some situations, you might want to run a certain block of code, if the code inside the try clause ran without any errors. For these cases, you can use the optional else keyword, with the try statement, to define a block of code to be executed, if, and only if, no errors were raised. Please note that, exceptions in the else clause are not handled by the preceding except clauses. Here is an example that will divide the integer 1 by 1 and store its result in the variable x. If an error occurs during this process, an exception is raised, then the except clause will catch and handle this error, printing out, "Something went wrong." Else, it will print out, "Nothing went wrong," because the program did not run into any exceptions, and the else clause was executed. That is great. You can catch exceptions, handle them properly, and execute some code when no exceptions are raised. But, how would you execute a block of code, even though an error occurred? Let's find out throughout the next section. The try and except statement in Python has another and optional finally clause. The finally block, if specified, will always be executed, regardless if the try block raises an error or not, and under any circumstances. Imagine that you always have to implement some sort of action to clean up after executing your code. Well, Python allows you to do so, using the finally clause. This can be very useful to close objects, release and clean up external resources, and so forth. For instance, you may be connected to a remote data center through the network, or working with a file. In all these circumstances, you must clean up the resource before the program comes to a halt, whether it successfully ran or not. All these actions, closing a file or disconnecting from network, are performed only in the finally clause, to guarantee its execution. Therefore, the program can continue properly, without leaving the file object open. Raising an exception. In Python programming, built-in exceptions are raised when errors occur, at runtime. But, as a Python developer, you can also choose to manually throw an exception, if a condition is met, at any time. To raise such an exception, use the raise reserved keyword. This statement can be complemented with a custom exception. You can optionally define what kind of error to raise, and pass values to the exception, in order to clarify why that exception was raised. Then, the program comes to a halt, and displays your exception to screen, offering clues about what went wrong, and help debugging. User-defined exceptions. In Python, users can define their own custom exceptions, by creating a new class. This exception class has to be derived, either directly or indirectly, from the built-in exception class. Note that most of the built-in exceptions are also derived from this class. Here, we have created a user-defined exception, called CustomError, which inherits from the exception class. This new exception, like any other exception, can be raised using the raise statement, with an optional error message. Classes and object-oriented programming will be covered in a next video, so be sure to subscribe. And that's it, you can now define your own exceptions and handle them individually, in a very different way. In this complete Python tutorial for beginners, you have discovered exceptions in Python, so that you can define, raise, catch and handle these exceptions in Python. Therefore, you should now be able to catch these errors in your program, without even interrupting its execution flow. Consequently, exceptions in Python should not be a secret anymore, and you can start using them in your Python program, straight away. If you liked this video, please, do not forget to give a thumb up, and subscribe our channel. Digital Academy, learn free. Thanks for watching this video. Please subscribe. Hit the notification bell, like, comment, and share.